Progressive brings you Flowetry with Flo.
When Flo flows, she flows in the know. Mind ruminates, the rates. Shown them all, I heed the call. Seeing the rest, I choose the best. Sometimes it's ours, sometimes it's not. When the fox walks, is it called a fox trot? That's a real question.
Compare Progressive direct rates with competitors' rates. Visit progressive.com. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and affiliates. Comparison rates not available in all states or situations. Prices vary based on how you buy.
Hi, I'm Stunning Stella Cheeks.
And I'm the Enigma Erin Klein.
And this is
Not Your Demographic,
a feminist wrestling podcast.
Shockingly, those exist.
Are you kidding me?
No.
You just went, that's a, yeah.
Well,
that's
I don't know. I don't know how to do an air horn. Fuck you, Stella.
I'm in charge of the sound effects.
You're right. You are in charge of the sound effects. You're right. Okay, fine.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, everyone.
Welcome to our show. We are clearly full energy, which is unusual.
Full of energy and feel the glow punch. I'm not even going to lie. I'm already drunk.
We just recorded a podcast before this.
We did.
And we have two special guests on our podcast to talk about the insanity that was the ultimate thrill ride.
WrestleMania!
We have the co-hosts of the Hard Times pod with us, Elle Collins and Megan. I don't know how to say your last name.
Nielsen. Hi.
Hey, guys.
Welcome. So the way that we decided to do this for Mania Weekend, because Mania Weekend is insanity, we've split up our podcast, like Elle said, on her podcast in a very comic book summer special way,
where crossover.
You can listen to us talk about the Hall of Fame and NXT TakeOver on the Hard Times Pod podcast, which you can find on iTunes and other places.
Mainly iTunes, but yeah, we're also at hardtimespod.com.
And at hardtimespod on Twitter, right?
Yes.
With the best theme song introduction. I love the music that you choose, personally, for all your podcasts, because I listen to all of your podcasts, Elle. I'm a fangirl. I was a fangirl before I started this podcast and we became friends on Twitter, so.
Oh, I didn't even know that. That's fine to know.
I'm not a hipster Elle Collins fan.
Oh, I remember when I started interacting on Twitter.
Well, you know what we've never talked about, but I've always been curious about, Stella, is whether or not I may have bought comics from you.
Oh, it's possible.
I don't know.
I literally had, I had my hold box at Challengers Comics.
Really?
When I lived in Chicago, yeah.
I only worked at Challengers for a short period of time. I've been going to Challengers for a long time, and then there was a time when I was unemployed, and the owners are incredible, and they were like, you're unemployed. Do you want to work here so you can get your comic books for free? And I was like, yes, please. Because I am one of those people that still has like a whole box that has way too many comics. Yeah.
So when did you start working there?
I worked there fall of 2015.
Yeah.
Into summer of 2016.
Okay. Yeah. No, I was already gone from Chicago by that point. I wasn't sure when you started because I left Chicago at the end of 2014.
Okay.
Okay.
But like when I think back to going to Challengers, like the best I can remember is that a lot of cool looking girls with tattoos work there. So it's not like I could say for certain that any of them weren't you.
Challengers is like a hardcore like Valkyries store, which is awesome. Yeah. I mean, there's some tattoos, but the owners were they're really great, and they were like, I pull so many comic books that at several times in my period of going there, they've made me come behind the counter and delete some of them. They were like, Penny, we get money from you and we think you read to me. where were we? Oh, yes. I'm an OG Elle Collins fangirl. Sorry.
It's totally okay. I was too. And now Elle is like my best friend. So like it works out being an OG Elle Collins fan.
It's a horrible place sometimes, but it's also a beautiful and magical place.
Yeah. It's really true.
I totally agree with that.
I guess like we have so much to talk about and we're just already tangent out because it's not your demographic. We have a lot of energy. Me and Erin have had a lot of punch. Let's talk about WrestleMania. So the way that we're going to do this is we're going to talk about the whole show match by match and then kind of talk about the fallout that happened either on Raw, SmackDown, or 2-5 Live, because that counts.
That's a thing that happened.
did you guys watch Raw and SmackDown and 2-5 Live?
I did not watch 2-5 Live because it's not on Hulu.
That's fine.
So
very proud of you for watching Raw and SmackDown.
Mm-hmm. You know what? I used to watch it every week, and then I kind of gave up. So maybe this will like get me back into it, because I did watch both Raw and SmackDown, the Hulu version, but I only ever watch the Hulu version because I don't have cable and I'm too lazy to torrent. So
I'm excited to get your opinions on it as someone who does not regularly watch it as well. I think that will be an interesting way.
It's been probably like since January, December, since I was regularly watching WWE TV.
Okay, that's fair. That's like the opposite of
what I watched. I've watched the past couple episodes just because of SmackDown, not Raw, just because I was so into the Randy Orton Bray Wyatt thing, because I love Bray Wyatt, but I'm like pretty much out of the loop on weekly TV. So
okay. That's fair. All right, cool. Watch weekly, Elle. Okay, so unfortunately, Elle has popped out for a second because her power went out for a second because weather is crazy. You know how it is. Global warming. Oh, Rick Perry's on the National Security Council. Whatever.
Get out of here. I don't even know.
But Steve Bannon is not.
We'll just talk politics for 15 minutes.
That's true. Steve Bannon's off. So, like, the cancer has been removed, but now there's, like,
but at the same time, they're also fucking saying that Steve Bannon was only there to monitor Michael Flynn when, like, they said that there was nothing that Michael Flynn that ever did that was wrong until now when they need to remove Steve Bannon from the National Security Council. Oh, my God, my brain's going to explode. Oh my God, I'm so angry. Although I am very excited as a follow-up to the Supreme Court justice news that we have been like sly reporting on. It legit feels like the Republicans are going to have to change the rules in order to get Gorsuch through, which like, fuck you guys. Like, you want to dig your own? Okay. That's fine.
Can I say something like a little bit potentially controversial?
Yes.
Not that I'm into Gorsuch, but like it's a little bit wild to me that like, the only person who's even remotely qualified for the job is the first person that the Dems have decided they're going to block. Like, what?
Well, there is a long history. It's not even about the stolen seat. There's a long history of Republicans blocking Democratic judges. So much so that when the Republicans or when the Democrats got the when they were in the majority, Harry Reid did the nuclear option for the lower courts because he was like, I'm so sick of this, like, 10-year ban of you guys blocking our judges. Like, we got voted into office. I'm going to do the nuclear option. And then it kind of cooled out for a while, and they got two justices in under Obama. And then fucking Mitch McConnell, hypocrite of all hypocrites, was like,
God, he's the worst.
No, we're not going to let you in. That's so ridiculous for you to have a third seat, especially in the last year. We'll wait till the next president. But then he goes on Meet the Press, and fucking Chuck Todd's like, so are you comfortable making it a rule that a president can't nominate a judge to the court within their last year? And he's like, no, that's a ridiculous question. Yeah. You know what? You're a ridiculous turtle.
Yeah.
Please die.
He's a ridiculous turtle.
I mean, also, Gorsuch is technically qualified, I would say, but there's a lot of red flags. Like,
yeah, there's so many red flags.
The fact that he won't meet with female, like he won't meet with our senator, like Tammy Duckworth. He won't meet with her. He won't meet with...
That's so weird to me. And then people were just like, oh, that's like a traditional Christian household thing. And I'm like, nah, no, man. Like, my grandparents were like uber Catholic, but that was like, that's not, nope. No, yeah. That's not normal. Like,
man, it's so fucked up. So that's a big part of it.
You can make arguments that he's qualified, but you can also make a lot, many, many arguments that he like hates women.
Well, he also, he hates women, and he also hates unions, and he's ruled
totally
over and over and over that he is definitely going to rule in favor of conservative opinions. And so I think that's a big part of it too. Like, yes, they should be allowed to nominate people because they're in the majority that fit their ideals. Like, Democrats do the same thing, liberals do the same thing. I understand that that's the whole point of the court, is that over time it balances. But if you're going to steal a fucking seat, you don't get to nominate someone who's like
fair. And maybe like, I don't personally, like, he would not be my personal choice, but like, he has like more experience than anyone else the Trump administration has like tried to nominate. Yes. And like, he's the person they're going to block. But you're right, the judges is like a whole separate thing.
For two reasons. They're doing it now because it really plays to their base, and it's going to happen eventually. Like, the nuclear option has been an option on the table that's gonna, like, anybody who knows anything, it's gonna happen. Saying that you don't know anything, I'm just saying, like the people who know in politics, whatever. So it's a really important stand for them to do it now and make a stand, because no matter what they do, it's gonna go away. Yeah. We're talking about politics. We just started talking about politics until we came back.
I wanted to talk about something that relates to both politics and Tennessee for a second, which is a response to something that you all talked about on the last Not Your Demographic episode, which is about Kane being a libertarian.
Yes. Oh, geez.
Is he not?
Because, no, he is a libertarian, and he's also, the city that he's running for mayor of is the city I live in.
Really?
Are you serious? Elle, do not vote for Kane.
Well, I don't know. I'm interested to hear why you want to vote for Kane.
No, I'm not saying I'm going to vote for Kane. Although at this point, I don't know what the election is going to look like. I'm not totally ruling out voting for Kane. Because here's what I wanted to say. I usually hate libertarians.
Yes, correct.
But in local Tennessee politics, like, Kane is going to run for mayor as a Republican. And because he's been a wrestler for, you know, 20 plus years, and all the, like, rednecks know him and think he's cool, he'll probably, like, be the Republican nominee for mayor. Okay. And ordinarily, any Republican that runs here is, like, super Christian, socially conservative, strongly anti-gay, you know, barely veiled racist.
Okay.
And so to actually have a libertarian running as a Republican, like, that could be, like, the best looking race we've ever had for mayor.
That is a really fair point.
Okay, yeah, that's actually awesome to know. Like, not awesome that
will
most of those people are
shitty.
Will
you please keep us heated on this race, since you will be so locally tied to it?
I did not know that that was this race. I am.
Also, regardless of the fact that I probably won't vote for Kane for mayor, I'm 100% going to go to a campaign event just so I can meet Kane and get it and be like, I support your campaign, and then just take a Mark photo with him.
I was just going to say, show up to one of his, like, campaign opportunities with a full Kane mask on. Just
I'll do it.
Do it.
I was like, can I get away with showing up to a Republican rally?
Yeah, I think it's a great choice.
Absolutely. Do it.
Yeah.
Not to peer pressure you, but to totally do
it. Oh, also in the beginning, we got so distracted by talking about all the alcohol that we were consuming that we forgot to talk about what t-shirts we're wearing.
Yeah, wrestling shirts.
What wrestling shirt are you wearing, Erin?
I'm wearing my Impact wrestling shirt.
Why?
I wore it on purpose because I looked at my drawer this morning and was like, I could wear my Shinsuke shirt. I could wear my fucking Brother Nero Cassius Ono Chris Hero shirt. I could wear my Heidi Love.
Do you have that shirt? I'm so jealous.
I have so many shirts,
I have, like,
Megan.
60 shirts. It's disgusting. It's a problem. So I was looking through my drawer and I was like, I have so many people's shirt I want to wear. I should pick someone who doesn't fit in the WrestleMania. And I was like, who didn't have a great weekend? who had, like, the least exciting part of their weekend? And I saw my Impact shirt and I was like, fuck that owl. I'm totally going to wear that shirt today. So I'm wearing my Impact shirt from when it was TNA, even though now it's Impact, but this, I bought it when it was still good, before it
you
turned
did,
in.
And it is a cool vintage.
It is a very cool vintage-y looking shirt. It's a royal blue, which looks really good on me, so I'm also a fan of it.
I am wearing my Sasha Banks Legit Boss shirt. It's my OG one, just because I'm, like, waiting for a heel turn, and also because her hair looked so good at WrestleMania.
So good.
Looked really good.
It's so good.
Also the best her makeup has looked in, like, a hot minute.
Yes.
Great.
Yes.
I mean, all those women looked great. We'll get to it.
Yeah. I'm just, like, a huge, like, stickler for makeup, and she looked fantastic.
Yes. Agreed. Yeah.
Are you guys wearing wrestling shirts?
I am wearing my Kobold Prince of All Goblins shirt.
Awesome.
Fantastic. I thought if I'm going to be on Not Your Demographic and we talk about wrestling shirts, I want to wear a shirt of a wrestler who has never been mentioned on Not Your Demographic before.
Awesome. That's a great idea. I love it.
And if you're friends with me on Facebook, my profile pic for a long time has been me and Kobold.
Awesome.
And he is a, well, okay. He's had a heel turn since I met him.
How do you feel about the heel turn?
But in my experience, he was a very friendly goblin. And like when you meet him, he talks to you in a goblin voice and refers to you as human, as in like, hello, human.
I love that.
I love amazing. People who are so committed to their character.
I do too. I think it's amazing. I mean, that's part of why I feel like Chikara is a good fit for you and I to both be watching, because everyone in Chikara is so committed to their characters. Like,
yeah, it's true.
Everybody just
believes. Amazing. It's amazing.
Megan, are you wearing a wrestling shirt?
Yeah, Finn Balor, the Balor Club.
Yes. We did it.
Yes. Well, see, I knew, though, going into this, what to expect, so I made sure. Yeah, that's like, I love my Finn Balor shirt. It's like probably too small for me, but whatever.
Did you see the new Finn Balor shirt? Because it's dope.
I love it. I think it's
yeah, I'm super annoyed. Okay, so like, I didn't buy the Demon one, because like, it's fine, but like, I don't know. And so I have the Balor Club shirt, and I thought that the Balor Club shirt was like super like hot. Like, I love that design. And then there's like a new one, and I'm like, how dare you put out a cooler shirt after I already have this cool shirt of yours?
Yeah, the Finn shirt.
Right, I'm about to have like four fucking Finn shirts because I like all of them basically. I didn't get just the jaws of the demon. I have the face of the demon.
It is now though, so that's cool.
That's true.
Completed so hard.
It is hard.
Okay. We have to talk about wrestling because there's so much fucking wrestling.
Okay, yeah, we gotta get through this.
Yeah,
we
like almost 5 hours of fucking wrestling.
Okay, let's talk about WrestleMania. So the pre-show had three matches on it. It opened with Neville, the king of the cruiserweights.
King of the cruiserweights.
My boyfriend, Austin Aries. You know what? Nick doesn't even get mad when I say that because I love him so
much. It's so true. It's not a real thing.
Not that he would get mad. It's fake.
Yeah.
I'm not really in a relationship with Austin Aries. But if he wanted, you know, whatever.
Okay. First, before we do, yes, I want to talk about this. I want to talk real quick about the fake ring that was suspended above the ring and the way that the ramp was set up. I think it was brilliant on WWE's part because they had so many problems with the sun and the glare at WrestleMania last year starting it. Because it was on the West Coast. It was like 1 p.m. So the sun was up, like it didn't set for super long. And so they built this ring. It felt very much like it was specifically to control the way that the sun was being played so that their cameras could catch stuff. And it made that match way more enjoyable. Like the Cruiserweight match was one of my favorite matches of the whole night. And it was the first one. And I feel like if they had not built this ring over top of it to control the glare of the sun, it would not have been as good as it was. It would have been like last year with Ryback and Kalisto, where it was like, who gives a goddamn fuck about this? It's 11 in the morning.
Who gives a goddamn fuck about this? It's Ryback.
Well, but true. Absolutely.
I mean, for opening all of WrestleMania, Neville and Aries like brought a lot of energy.
Yes.
They were super true to their characters. And I thought it was a really good match.
I liked it.
It wasn't, you know, it wasn't a main event style match, but it was a really good match for them.
And I thought Aries was going to legit die a couple of times. Neville threw him into some neck like suplex where he landed on his neck, and I was like, oh, he's dead.
Yeah.
Killed him dead. Like,
my thing is always like, I'm always like screaming like, don't die for kayfabe, and yeah, like that 100% applies in this match. Oh my god, every indie show I go to, I yell it because the ring is so loud, it scares me. But like in this match, it was definitely like, don't die for the gimmick. Don't do it, please.
Yes, absolutely.
I loved Neville's gear too, the gold.
Yeah, I love people bringing out their WrestleMania gear where like, some of it's gold, some of it's just like white. I love it. I love that it's like, this is the purest we're going to be. Yeah, I love it. I think it's great. Leather. Leather.
So, unfortunately, Austin Aries lost. Though, on 205 Live, he won the number one contendership, so they're continuing this feud, which makes a ton of sense.
Yeah.
Like, they're really well-suited with each other. But somebody pointed to us on Twitter, Austin Aries lost by Neville putting his thumb in his eye. And while Austin Aries was on commentary, all he did was talk about how all you got to do is put your thumb in their eye. That's how you win, which was like kind of really like subtle, brilliant storyline.
Yeah, it was like
absolutely
heel booking.
Do you guys like his furry coat or do you miss the cape?
I like the coat. I like the furry coat.
I miss the cape.
I miss the cape too.
Megan, how do you feel?
Can I have both?
I want both too!
Because like, because I think that the furry coat is way more distinctive. Because I don't feel like, I feel like a lot of people have capes. Like no one else really has a furry coat. But also that cape. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I just really love watching Austin Aries wrestle. Like, I know I joke about it all the time, but like, I really love watching him wrestle.
He's a great wrestler.
I like his, like,
he's super good.
His jumpiness, like how he, like,
Aries,
when he like throws himself over the ropes, and he like does like little jumps, and like the way he gets into the last chancery, or like the pendulum swing, like it's just a very unique style of movement.
His pendulum swing makes me laugh every single time.
Yeah, but it's super unique.
I love it. Totally agree.
I am a huge Neville fan. I was sort of, I feel like this didn't come up for a long time because he was out for so long, but I sort of feel like Neville, about Neville, the way you talk about like New Day and Miz. Like I was in on Neville when he was a face and nobody gave a shit about him.
Yep. Yes.
And now so, you feel so vindicated.
Yeah, totally. Like he's so like universally accepted as awesome now, and that's the way that it should be. Because he's always been awesome, and he's been just that much better since he became the king of the cruiserweights.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. He his promo that he gave was on 205 Live was excellent. Yes, it was just like agreed. I love. He was like, I have to thank you. The thank you for not believing in me. I have to thank Austin Aries for being such a buffoon. Like
he was so good. I love it.
Also, his face when he was sitting next to commentary in the like office chair, holding the cruiserweight title in his like wrestling gear, grimacing at the ring was like. It was like really I need that as a screenshot because that is how I feel most of the time.
I was just talking about how much I like Neville, so I don't want to seem like I'm insulting him, but like Neville's face makes him such a better heel.
Oh yeah.
It's like, true. With the beard too, the fucking heel beard.
Yeah, and like literally that the reason that baby faces are called baby faces is that they're not supposed to look like Neville.
Yes, exactly. Totally 100%. When Nicole, my friend Nicole was watching it with me a couple of weeks ago, she was like, it was Jack Gallagher and Neville fighting each other, and her description of them was a piece of human chalk versus one of the trolls from Lord of the Rings. And I was like, oh, that's so accurate. Oh, you're totally right.
But here's the thing, like, Neville does not have a great face, and he's got big ears, whatever, but, like, the way he presents himself now, and the haircut, and the, like, heelishness, like, it really makes him, like, appealing, not just like not just like sexually or whatever, but like it's, you just are like drawn to him.
Yeah, I totally agree. Absolutely.
He's an excellent heel.
Yeah, very much is.
But sometimes I do think about him in his, like, remember in NXT where he would like wear his glasses and like his like jumper and be like, I'm from England.
Jack Gallagher for that.
Sometimes I think about Neville in a jumper with glasses and it makes me laugh.
It's so attractive. I refuse to apologize. When he was out and when he was in sweaters and had those square glasses all the time, I was so into it.
Oh, I love it.
I have a type with a capital T.
Square glasses and jumpers. I got it. 205 Live I thought was really good too. We'll just get out of the way before we talk about Mania. Rich Swann had a match, and then after the match, he basically was like, hey, Alicia, I'm the one that sent you the gifts, which is like finally good that storyline coming like full circle. I am still disappointed that it wasn't just Alicia sending herself gifts.
I mean, I would agree with that. I feel like I understand that there is criticism about Alicia Fox just being like the valet who's getting passed around the cruiserweights. It feels more to me like Alicia Fox is kind of serving like a Sensational Sherry role where like she gives people a rub by being associated with them because she's been around for so long and she's fucking insane, like certifiable, eats perfume, loony, insane. And like the fact that everyone wants to be associated with her, I think makes her look better, even though she's not wrestling, and like they're using her, even though she's not wrestling. And also it makes these cruiserweights look like, hey,
like a part of the main roster.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, I'm associating with this person that you've known for 9 years. And so I'm getting this rub off of her. And I feel like she's doing a great job in the same way that Sherry did, where it's like, my job is to bring these people up and to make people love them. And I think that Alicia's doing a great job of that. Like, we love Cedric. Like, yeah, we may have loved Cedric before. We did. But there are people who were like, yeah, Alicia's with this person. I want to associate with him. Okay, I can dig him on his own. Now he's with Gnome. Okay, great. Yeah, like, I'm totally into her in this, like, weird slap this dude in the face relationship. Like, I can see how people dig into this. And, like, as Rich Swann also, like, I was already the champion. I had this run. People already know me. Now I'm also tagging up with this woman who's going to bring me up and elevate me in this way. Like, I think this is also a great sign for the way that WWE is pointed with the way they treat their women. Like, it's not, I'm a crazy, weird, sexist stereotype. It's, I'm a strong woman who all these men want to be with because I elevate them. I love it. I think it's so awesome.
It's a really good spot for her.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
I was really, when it was just about her and Cedric and Noam Dar, I was largely against it, but I've come around a lot.
Yeah, I think they're handling it correctly. It felt like it could go very gross and go very weird, and I think that they've pointed it in the absolute right direction for her and for everybody else. I feel like if you make her gross and weird, it's going to make everyone else feel gross and weird. If you use her in an effective way that's appropriate, everyone else looks good too. Everybody gets that rub.
Yeah. There was also one more moment on 205 Live that I wanted to talk about. So there was the Fatal 4-Way at the end that was for the number one contendership, which Austin Aries won. There's this awesome moment where Mustafa Ali was on the corner, sitting on the corner, and TJ Perkins was, like, about to, like, go put him into, you know, like, a electric chair or whatever. And then Jack Gallagher and Austin Aries look at each other and, like, oh, let's go get a part of this. They, like, beat TJ Perkins down, push his face into the turnbuckle, and then use him as a ladder to suplex Mustafa Ali. Yes. And they just stood there on TJ Perkins, using him as, like, a step stool for, like, 30 seconds, and it was gratifying.
It was very gratifying.
And it was also a cool move. I've never seen that before.
It was also, they did that, like, DDT chain, too, where Austin Aries did that DDT, and they were, like, all right in a row.
It was Mustafa Ali who did it.
Yeah, you're right. And so I felt like that was also a good, they did that first, and then to do that, like, weird fuck TJ Perkins tree of woe, it was, like, a really good capstone on top of that as well. I thought that the Cruiserweights did a good job of, like, oh, main roster, you can build these weird human structures? Fuck you, watch us build some human structures.
It was a good match. Everyone had great moments. And you know what? TJ took that face into the turnbuckle like a champ.
Yeah, he really did.
He really played it up. I thought it was very funny.
I like TJ as accepting that he's a bland, boring human being.
Oh my god, he sucks, right?
Yeah.
Like, not like as a wrestler. Like, I don't, but it's like, I don't care that you lived in your car. Haven't we all lived in our cars? Like, I don't really give a shit. I don't really give a shit. Like, his whole character was like, oh my god, I lived in my car and now I'm here. And I'm like,
and the whole video game.
Have you met Rich Swann?
The whole video game gimmick is like, that's not for you.
Right? Like, I love it, but it's not for you.
Like, why doesn't the New Day have that? Or like Xavier as a solo. You know what I mean? I don't know. I just don't get why he gets video games. Like, does he extra love them? Has he ever been on Up, Up, Down, Down? I don't know.
Also, the UK boys were there, and they were like, we're going to have... They were part of WrestleMania Access, and we're going to have a UK weekly show coming up soon. Details coming soon, which is exciting. And also, Tyler Bate looked fucking hot.
Oh my god. Those gray pants, the suspenders, the black shirt, the, like, calico glasses. So, like, oh my god.
Such a good look.
Hugging the belt like it was a blanket. I was like, oh my god, I love you. This is amazing.
Tyler Bate is such a good boy.
He's such a good boy.
He's so cute.
Oh. He hit on me at Trios, and it was the highlight of my life. I'm never letting it go.
Never, ever letting it go. Never.
I'm never letting it go. Like, every time somebody's like, oh, Tyler Bate, I'm like, oh, he hit on me at King of Trios.
No,
but like,
we're basically dating.
So, well,
all right, so moving on, there was the Andre the Giant Battle Memorial Royale. Did I say that right?
Yes, you did.
So proud of
you. You nailed it. You got a lot of wine, so I'm impressed.
So, I think this match can easily be seen as a throwaway match. Sometimes I don't feel that way, but, like, this year I definitely did feel that way. What did you guys feel?
I was really sad that the Big Show didn't have something better to do because he's retiring.
No! I know. I mean, they gave him an entrance. He was one of two people who got an entrance. Him and Braun got entrances. But yeah, him and Braun got eliminated very quickly.
Which I think honestly was good for the count, for like the direction of the match. It was very surprising and it made people be like, oh, I need to watch this because I thought they were going to win. But you're right. Like, poor Big Show, this was his last WrestleMania and he got like dog shit for it. Like,
yeah, but he did win that trophy one time. And also Big Show, I feel like, is one of the guys that's like, whatever.
Yeah,
I don't think Big Show's a big fit about it.
That's true. I think he's disappointed about Shaq, but also at the same time, like, why are you surprised? Everyone should have known that Shaq was never going to be able to do this match. Like, that's kind of sad, but...
Wait, why was he... Okay, see, I don't get it. Like, why did Shaq drop out?
Big Show got fit, and then Shaq was like, no, this is supposed to be two old fat guys wrestling, and now it's just two guys, one is fat and one is not fat.
Got it. Okay. Because, like, I was so hyped for that. Like, if you go back into the Hard Times archive, you can hear me being so psyched. And then you can hear my heartbreak when Elle, like, tells me that Shaq has dropped out. I'm like, what? No. Like,
I was disappointed too.
Yeah,
that's rumors, but like that seems plausible to me. That Shaq was like, no, I don't want to be the old fat guy.
Well, I have some NBA friends who were like, if you had asked anyone who knows the NBA, they could have told you that Shaq was never going to show up and shave. And it's like, oh yeah, it's true. Shaq never showed up and shave, even when he was a basketball player, and it was literally his job. So like, why the fuck would he show up in shape for WrestleMania? So, like, it sort of makes sense that it didn't actually work. But it is really disappointing to think for, like, a whole year that it's going to happen, and then it's just like, wah, wah, sorry, Big Show got eliminated.
You know what else is disappointing? That Sami Zayn didn't win.
Oh, my God, so disappointing.
Wait, okay, but hold on. Is it really disappointing, though? Because Rob Gronkowski is in this match.
Fuck you, Megan.
Why are you there?
Whatever. Y'all are just fucking bitter because we won the Super Bowl. I don't know if you are, but that's my, like, inherent response.
I watch football.
I don't give a fuck.
I do. See, I do watch football. That's my guy. That is my guy.
Gronkowski looks like a troll. I don't need this in my life.
I get it.
I was so upset that nobody, because I don't typically watch the pre-show. It's like my thing. I did
now. It's part of that
time because so many like actual matches were on the pre-show. So I did this time, but I was like, why the fuck didn't anybody tell me Gronk was on the fucking pre-show? Look, all I'm saying, I don't know. You're right. Sami Zayn like should have like. I don't understand.
WrestleMania is about moments. There's crossover. They like to have people like Ronda Rousey, Shaq, whatever. The Gronk thing, but, like, it made sense. And Sami got a good moment on Raw. So, like, I get it. Sami still looked good in the match, but I get it. Mojo needs something to do without Zach.
That's the part where I'm confused. Like, what is pushing Mojo Rawley going to do? Like, because I don't buy for a second that they're going to make him, like...
They'll have more money to buy zebra suits.
Okay, here's the... They're called Zubaz, first of all. Second of all, that's the pants that he's wearing. And second of all, we complain, not just we, universal we, people who watch WWE complain very often that all they do is bring back legends and push them a lot. Mojo is young, and Mojo is one of their new talent, and they want to push him, and I don't know that he'll ever be 100% top geared main event dude. He could be a Miz though. Like, he's very relatable. He has a lot of famous sports friends.
He's
like,
got that football style,
yes, exactly,
that people could relate,
like,
to.
He's very relatable and he loves what he does. It's infectious. Like, he's not a great wrestler, but he's a Miz 10 years ago wrestler. Like, that's where he is. And if they continue to push him, that means that later he can be a very reliable person to them. And I also feel like Mojo's going to be loyal in a way that Miz is loyal, and they recognize that and want to encourage him to stay with them as long as possible. So I feel like, I know that I'm the person who's like, the business and the numbers, we need to push these things, but it's also true. Like, they really want to encourage him to stay around, to be loyal to them, and so I feel like that's a big part of why they're pushing him. I don't know that he'll ever really break past this, but I don't think he needs to, and I think that this is a good way for him.
Like, I don't have a problem with them pushing Mojo. I just didn't really understand why, because I can't see them, like, pushing him further. But what you're saying makes sense.
I didn't, like most people, I did not care about Mojo Rawley at all until they did that Breaking Ground series, behind the scenes at NXT when he was still at NXT, and he's so likable in that.
Yeah, I mean, he's a likable guy. And also, like, to me, I was like, okay, in the long run, this is great for Zack Ryder, so I'm fine with it.
Yeah, totally.
Because I love Zack Ryder. Also, like, Sami Zayn had good moments on Raw following. Like, he had that great moment with Kurt Angle, where Kurt Angle was really playing into the, like, annoying Sammy, but, like, we all love annoying Sammy bit. Like, that was great. And his, you know, Jinder Mahal is kind of there to be, like, a Kurt Hawkins, I guess. Yeah. But, like, they had a good match, and Sammy won, and Sammy needs some wins. So even though he technically lost at WrestleMania, he had a good night the following night, and who knows what's going to happen in this shakedown.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah.
Any other thoughts on this match, this angle?
I'm happy Killian Dane made it all the way to the, like, third spot. The
final three.
Yeah. I thought that was a really good move on their part. I thought it was a good way for them to bring NXT people into the light, even though they weren't, like, super clear about who he was or why he was there. I thought, like, just the optics of him was a really good move on their part and will draw people to their NXT product, which is what they want. And I also feel like, good for Jinder Mahal. Like, I know it's super weird and ridiculous, but...
he has a crazy body.
Oh, my God. He's only been with them for, like... how long? Like, 6 months? And has just turned into, like, a ridiculous robot human? He's in so such good shape.
Well, I mean, hasn't he been around, but didn't he, like, just come back 6 months ago? Or was he, like, fresh 6 months ago?
When he came back, he was, like, in good shape.
He looked
shape.
Like Sami Zayn. They were in, like, similar shape.
Yeah, he, like,
honestly.
Was in got good it. Shape, but it was fine. But then he became, like...
jacked. He's, like, in, like, hot
a
jacked.
Scary way.
Jacked. It's, like... is this a legal way for you to be Jack? I am uncertain, because how do you work out this often? It's like, he must have no friends. He works out so often.
He has that that look like bodybuilders when they, like, deliberately dehydrate themselves. Yes! So you can see all their veins and muscles. Like, he looks super dehydrated.
Yes, I 100% agree with that.
Yeah, it's creepy, but, like, it works, I guess.
Yeah, and good for him for being rewarded with being second. And he was the person in Raw who made it the furthest, which,
and,
like,
you know,
is
what?
A good mark for him.
He's been on Raw, like, many weeks in a row. So he's, like, always there. Like, so,
yeah, exactly.
Good
he's,
for him.
I know. I just get bummed because I feel like he should be doing more.
Yeah. Yeah, but, like, what would he be doing? Like, he is there.
No, you're not wrong. It just is, like, so weird for me to be, like, Sami Zayn went from, like, one of the hottest guys on the roster to, like, now he's, like, maybe.
I thought you were talking about Jinder, and I was like, Jinder is exactly where he needs to be.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, I don't want to see Jinder anymore.
I'm sorry. Were we talking about I lost connection at some point.
Sammy,
we were
I agree. I think
Sami should be doing more. Yes.
But I think... you know, maybe I'm being, like, hopeful fool, but I feel like they're building to Sammy doing more right
yeah.
now.
Yeah. And I
hope so. I get really worried and jaded about things, but I'm not trying to be. Like I hope he does more. I just am nervous.
I think that either they're deliberately building Sammy as the next Daniel Bryan. And when I say the next, I mean, like, the next WrestleMania 30 Daniel Bryan.
Yes, I totally agree
with
that.
Yeah, that's how underdog story.
I don't think they're doing it on purpose, though.
That's what I was going to say. Either they're doing it on purpose, or they're doing it the way they did with Daniel Bryan, which is ignoring him for a long time, and then at some point they'll realize how much everyone loves him and give him that push. Like, one way or another, that's where he's headed.
Absolutely.
I 100% agree with that. I think that's exactly what they're doing, that they don't understand why he's popular for the same reasons they didn't understand why Daniel Bryan was popular, and, like, we're going to get to that point where they're like, oh, fuck, everybody wants this. In the same, like, we had this Raw moment during the Paul Heyman promo where everyone was chanting, we want Baylor, where it was like, this is crystallized that this is what we want. I think we're going to get to that point with Sammy where people are like, with the yes chant, with the we want Baylor, like, there will be a moment in time where Vince is like, I cannot deny this anymore that people want this. And it feels like Sammy is very much building to that point. And, like, people love him. He's a good dude. Like, I think part of his appeal is that he is a legitimately good person and, like, really honestly wants other people and other humans to have a good life. And, like,
and a phenomenal wrestler.
Yeah, and he's a phenomenal wrestler. I feel like it would be very weird to push against him as a company and as a brand that, like, fuck this dude for being a good person. So I feel like eventually he's going to get to that point. Everyone is going to be Daniel Bryan levels of excited.
Mm-hmm. And then we had our final match of the pre-show, which was Dean Ambrose versus Baron Corbin.
Woo! Okay, wait, no, hold on. I take back my woo. My woo was initially just for Dean Ambrose because he's my wrestling boyfriend. However,
respect.
After watching SmackDown, I'm, like, pissed about this match.
Yeah.
So, like,
Mania match, that,
That's Street Fighter. I was like, okay, so like, I was in the shower while I was watching this Dean Ambrose Baron Corbin Street Fighter match. So I may not have been the most focused, but I went
wrestling in the shower too.
There's like a nice little place for me to prop my phone up, and I can just watch wrestling. It's really nice. but like, I was like so mad. Because I was like, why wasn't this the WrestleMania match? Their match on SmackDown, like, not to jump the gun and immediately start talking about SmackDown.
We're going to lump it all.
But their match on SmackDown was like 10 fucking times better than the match they had on WrestleMania, which just seems like weird to me.
I think sometimes they try and book things like, let's, you know, slow build, blah, 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 blah. But like, there's...
But Mania's not the time to do that.
Exactly, exactly. And also, like, the street fight that they had on SmackDown wouldn't have, like, been so hot that they would have blown all the other matches out. Like, it would have still fit in. The street fight was legitimately good. It wasn't just like, oh, my God, this is so much better, end stop. It was, like, actually a good match. And it, like, I understand that they wanted Dean to retain, which, like, thank God he did, and the street fight was not for the belt. But, like, I totally agree. I feel it bad for Dean because, like, the past few years he's had, like, terrible.
He's gotten fucking shivved in Mania, like, 2 years in a row now, and it's garbage.
In the ladder match 2 years, or the 3 years ago or whatever. But
that was 3 years ago. That was 3 years ago. He was the champion. Okay, look, I'm extra impassioned because I am in love with him, but, like, this is objective and right. Like, like, he was their champion. He was a top guy before he was the champ. Why the fuck are you sleeping on him at your pay-per-views? I don't get it.
Well, I feel like being that he's the third member of the Shield, he should be fighting Triple H at the next WrestleMania, right?
He's already fought Triple H at Roadblock a year and a half ago.
And that was one of the best matches year.
I feel like the problem is that Dean is, like, a reliable person to him. They talk about it all the time. Like, Dean never misses a date. Dean is there. So, like, he's there when you need him to be the champ. But he's there to fill the mid-card all the time. And I feel like they rely on him for that, that they sometimes forget that, like, Dean is a top guy.
Well, I feel like Dean is the new Miz. And not that their characters are similar, but that it's that same thing where they're going to rely on him. He's going to be there forever. He agrees to do these things.
No one is the new Miz. Miz is the Miz.
Well, no, like, new era Miz responsibilities. That's what...
No, you're like, so right. Like, because Miz was, like, super, super hot, and then I slept on him for, like, 3 years, and now he's, like, you know, the Miz again. And I feel like that's what's happening with Ambrose. Like, you can see him not give a shit. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. You can see it in his eyes, and that was the same thing with the Miz, where you could, like, see that the Miz, like, didn't give a shit.
Yes, absolutely. And also, I'm going to offer this counterpoint. I feel like it may have been because they moved the Intercontinental match to the pre-show where it belonged. It should have been on the pre-show. They did not do enough storyline and SmackDown storyline building to get to this as a WrestleMania main card match. But because it was on the pre-show, they felt like, on purpose, we should make the SmackDown match more interesting because WrestleMania isn't just WrestleMania. Like, yes, it is a 7-hour long show, but WrestleMania is now also WrestleMania, Raw, and SmackDown. It's 3 whole days of storyline. And I feel like this is one of those matches that feels in that transitional period where it's like everything on WrestleMania should be incredible. And yes, it should be, but what we really needed was then to have a great match on SmackDown to draw in casual viewers to.
That's fair. I don't know. You're probably fair. I just feel like, sorry, I'm probably cutting somebody off.
No. Megan, this is your boyfriend. Go for it.
Yeah, he is. And I've had like a couple glasses of wine now, so I'm impassioned.
Demographic.
Yeah, I don't know, and I don't disagree. I'm not saying that them having a great match on SmackDown was, like, bad. I just, like, it's disappointing, and especially if you take into account, like, the past few WrestleMania, I guess it's only been this one in the past. I don't like Brock Lesnar, but that match should have been better, and the match this year should have been better. I don't know. I just think that, like, I don't, and people, like, I said this somewhere, it wasn't on Twitter, it was probably somewhere on the internet, but someone was like, oh, well, it was on the pre-show, it didn't have to be good, and, like, that's not that it was bad, but, like, that's not really an excuse to me. I agree. It's still WrestleMania, and I still think that, like, Ambrose and even Corbin, I don't give a fuck about Corbin, but, like, if you're on the Mania card in any capacity, you should be able to have more of a moment. Yeah. And this did not feel like a moment at all.
I get that. I totally
agree. Yeah. If that makes sense.
No, I totally understand that.
I agree. But don't worry, because we're leaving the pre-show behind.
Later, pre-show. Okay,
yeah, I'm sorry. I almost kept going. Stop me. Cut me off.
No, I understand. I get it. If your boyfriend gets screwed over, you have feelings about it.
Yeah, I do.
So, moving on to the main card. The main card opens with the New Day hosting WrestleMania. Yes. Just in their Final Fantasy costumes, I guess?
Yes, that's what
Yes!
I didn't Final Fantasy, so I didn't get it, but I was like, New Day, I love it, so I don't care.
Baller.
It's disappointing that they didn't have anything else to do at Mania, but, like, they're the perfect host. They did a great job.
Also, worth it by Raw.
I mean, we're going to get there, relax.
How dare you?
Did you guys get their Final Fantasy costumes right away, or did you have to, like...
No.
I did, but I've played a lot of Final Fantasy games.
Not only did I not get the Final Fantasy costumes, I was real worried about Xavier's hair.
Oh, it reminded me of Punk Liberty Spikes. That's what it looked like, and I was like, oh, are you 15? What is that?
All I know is that Xavier only whips out the crazy hair on, like, big pay-per-views, so I was into it.
Yeah,
but only because, like, I think I have hardcore New Day blinders. I also love that their microphones look like New Day Pops now.
Yes, agreed. 1000%.
Okay, just like a counter opinion. I'm kind of tired, not currently, I guess, but I'm kind of tired of the New Day. Like, they were everywhere and everything for so long. I don't necessarily think it was bad. They didn't have more to do.
That's fair. I get that.
Wrong.
I will present this. I thought at first it was bad that they were hosting and we're not going to have a match. Now, looking back on it in hindsight, they get to go on every talk show and every news program and talk about WrestleMania.
And they're good at that. They're good at talking.
Yeah, they're good at talking, and they became the face of WrestleMania. And the fact that WWE, which is run by Vince McMahon, who is a person that we know some unfortunate things about, would trust three charismatic black men to be the face of his biggest program of the season is kind of amazing. Like, it made me very glad in hindsight that they were the ones who were the face of it and weren't just having a match, that they got to be like, we're going to be the ones who drum up this excitement, and we're going to bring this to you later. And so to bring them in later to face the Revival, which was also very exciting,
right?
Like, it felt very appropriate that, like, they're better than everyone, so we're not going to put them in this WrestleMania match because whatever, they'll just beat everybody. It's felt that way for a long time. And then to bring them back and be like, yeah, we hosted WrestleMania. We were the face of this. Motherfuckers, we're amazing.
We're the longest tag team champs.
We just took a break because WrestleMania meant we got to do all this fun shit. And now, also, like, it felt so satisfying.
Having them as hosts enabled that fake out that we'll get to.
Oh, absolutely.
Absolutely. You're totally right.
Did you guys win with the Revival? How did you feel about the Revival's call-up?
I think it's time. I don't necessarily know. Like, the Raw tag team division has not been super inspiring lately, but maybe the Revival can change that. I just think it's time. I think it's time for them to move up.
Yes, totally agree.
And there's nothing else for them to do on NXT, and I think it's time for them to be on the main roster, for better or for worse.
Yes. Elle, you made a good point on Twitter today, or yesterday, or Monday. I don't know. The whole world. where you said, like, it was really satisfying for all of, on Raw, where, like, all of the things that we thought were going to happen happened, but, like, it was actually still satisfying. Like, Angle and Finn and the Revival. Like, we all kind of knew that was going to happen, but, like, once it happened, it was really satisfying.
Yeah. And that continued on SmackDown, too, with Ty and Shinsuke.
Yes, absolutely. I totally agree with that.
I love that the Revival came in. They, like, came, you know, pardon my phrasing, but they came out hard. They like, shoulder-checked the New Day popsicle belt. And then they had
a card over.
They had a really good match with Big E and Xavier. And, like, I love when Xavier wrestles. He's such a fucking good wrestler. And I love that not only did they, you know, win that match, but then they went back and took out Kofi with their, like,
yes,
knee crusher, the thing that they've taken out other tag teams for. I think it, like, really set them as not only dominant tag team, but, like, somebody, like, not to mess with.
Yeah, I agree.
It was really smart. And also, like, it was fun. I like when wrestling is fun. That was fun.
Yeah, absolutely. And I thought they did a great job on Raw too. Like you said, the tag team divisions, period, Raw and SmackDown, have been very stagnant lately and have felt very empty and very, like, blah. But I feel like they did a really good job during this match, specifically of Revival versus New Day, of talking about all of the other tag teams and being like, here is what our division looks like. Here is what we're looking forward to. Here's who the Revival will have. Club, the...
Enzo and Cass,
the Hardy Boys, the Cesaro. Like, I felt like they did a really good job of incorporating all of that after we had already seen a section of the tag teams be reintroduced later. Like, I think that they have started to refocus on the tag teams, at least on Raw.
On SmackDown too, specifically after, like, Talking Smack. But yeah. I think they realized that they, like, let that division
stagnate.
Yeah.
It feels very stagnant lately, and I feel like, especially post-Mania, they're like, shit, we gotta commit to this. And in the same way that NXT is usually like that, where, like, they go in cycles, where, like, a tag team is really strong, women's division is really strong, men's division is really strong, and then they call a bunch of people up, and it's like, fuck, nothing is strong anymore. And I feel like SmackDown was going through that a lot, and Raw was feeling those effects from that same stuff, too. And it feels like post-Mania, they're really starting to get that in check. Like, we brought all these people up, we're ready for this, we're ready to keep going on this.
I agree.
Quick hot take. Yeah. Who's your favorite tag team right now? Period. On a WWE brand.
DIY.
Woo, good answer.
Second is Cesaro Sheamus. Wait, actually, no. I guess second is the Hardy Boys because they're back. But
yeah.
I'm such a Hardy Boys mark. I don't give a fuck.
Mine is Cesaro because kills.
So
yeah, no, that's fair. That's fair.
I love DIY and I love Cesaro, but I'm kind of all about the Usos right now.
Yeah,
I love you. Which I never thought I would say.
That's so, isn't that funny? It's so funny how wrestling does that, where you're like, my opinion right now compared to my opinion a year ago is shocking. Let's move on because we are barely into this fucking card. So the first official match was AJ versus Shane, which I was a little shocked at first, like, oh, this is the way we're opening it. But it was also kind of nice to get out of the way. All I got to say is AJ's hair in that wind, that was doing him some favors.
Yeah, I thought this was a really entertaining match. I don't look forward to Shane McMahon matches.
No.
But AJ Styles is good enough for two people at wrestling.
Yeah.
And the match had no right to be as good as it was.
True. No. I thought it was a little long, but I thought the match accomplished what it needed to accomplish. We still got a Shane McMahon spot with the coast-to-coast with the trash can, whatever. But even if it wasn't technically, like, great wrestling here and there, like Shane McMahon's shooting stars press onto his, like, broken knee. I'm surprised he was, like, walking. Shane McMahon must have, like, the most insane, like, body that, like, robot body that just rebuilds itself. Because, like, I don't know how his knees weren't, like, cracked in half.
Yeah.
But I thought that the psychology of it and the storytelling of it, like, carried those, like, lesser parts, if that makes sense. And also, like, AJ's hair in the wind was just, like, a beautiful thing.
It's true. It was basically like a L'Oreal commercial. It was kind of
insane.
Yeah,
it was like Garnier for Teresa.
Ooh, girl. Yeah, I felt like that match to me felt like garbage until the ref got knocked out. And it was like, oh, that's right. Shane can't wrestle. I love Shane in many ways for lots of reasons.
Here comes the money.
Dance. But he just like, he's not a wrestler, and that, like, one-armed Styles clash made me feel like he was going to die. There were a lot of moments where I was like, I am very uncomfortable with this. But as soon as it became a non-DQ match, basically, that's what it felt like. Like, it felt very appropriate for them, and I feel like Shane is very good at making that stuff work. And so the last part of their match was so satisfying. And, like, we needed an AJ win. Like, it was really important for AJ to win this, especially after losing to Jericho last year. Like, AJ won in the Raw after Jericho, in the Raw after Mania against Jericho last year, and so got his revenge on him in that same, like, WrestleMania is 3 days long concept. But as a WrestleMania, I felt like it was really important for AJ to get this, and I thought he had a good enough match that he can, like, claim the I opened WrestleMania and I fucking killed this title. Like, he did a really good job with that.
Also, we kind of talked about it. He had, like, a little bit of a face turn on SmackDown when he had the, like, you know what, Shane? I respect you. Shake hands.
Yeah, absolutely.
We'll see what happens with AJ. Yeah. AJ is going to be one of the, like, hot commodity wrestlers during the shakedown. Do you think he goes to Raw, or do you think he stays at SmackDown?
I'm going to say he stays at SmackDown.
I think so too, but I also think the relevant question is, if he goes to Raw, who leaves Raw for SmackDown? Because there's already a lot of top guys on Raw.
Top guys.
I would say Roman, because they want him to be on something that's popular, but he's fighting Brock, so he'll probably stay.
He's not moving.
Yeah, he'll stay on Raw.
Yeah, it's confusing because AJ, like, I feel like if you were just looking at it, you'd be like, oh, it makes sense for AJ to move. But AJ, like, made a huge point about me, like, SmackDown is the house that AJ built. Like, this is my house. Like, this is my yard.
I mean, you could send Finn to SmackDown. That's a thing that could happen.
I'm so intrigued. I actually have no idea.
I know, right? Like, I have a lot of ideas, but I have no idea who's moving where. Like, is maybe moves to Raw, but I don't know. Like, maybe. He doesn't really have anything to do with Shinsuke. I feel like if Miz leaves and is like, I don't want to deal with Shinsuke, fuck that, switch me, I don't want to be here with these fucking assholes anymore, like, in typical Miz fashion. I think, first of all, Maryse could be very well served on the snack or on the Raw women's division as a valet. Like, they could use her very well. But also, I feel like then Shinsuke can move on and be like, oh, hey, what's up, AJ Styles? Remember a year ago when we fought on Wrestle Kingdom 9 and beat the goddamn piss out of each other? Let's do that again. Like, I feel like there are a lot of options open if, like, Miz were to leave. Like, John Cena's not there right now. He's going to be filming a movie. He has the great opportunity to move. And he's a great staple for whatever division he's on. If he moves to Raw, he'll be consistent and be consistently good.
100%.
It's so hard to talk about this with, like, not knowing what's happening.
I know.
I know. Watch them, like, announce it, and then we're, like, 100% wrong. Like, just super fucking, like, not even, like, a little bit, but, like, everything we've said has been the opposite.
I hope everyone's listening to this on Thursday when it comes out.
Okay, so the next match was KO versus Jericho. So I had a big WrestleMania party, and me and Erin were in the kitchen getting, like, some more Feel the Glow punch. And then from the living room, it's Kevin and Chris, and we go, oh my god, this is not a drill, go. We, like, filled up our glasses and, like, ran into the living room like children.
That was a sight.
That being said, I was a little disappointed in this match.
I was too.
You should have been.
Nope. Thanks, Megan.
Well, it's true, because I'm, like, with you. Like, when I went into Mania, I was so soured from last year. Like, in my opinion, last year's WrestleMania was god-awful. And I was really sick the night of WrestleMania, like, physically ill, so I kind of didn't watch it. But, like, preemptively, I was like, I kind of only give a shit about three things. And, like, Jericho was one of those three things I gave a shit about. I ended up being proven wrong. I enjoyed the majority of Mania. But I was like, okay, so this is one of those only things. And then it was, like, fine. Like, it was a fine match.
It was a fine match.
But, like, I know both Jericho and Kevin Owens are capable of putting together a better match. And so I was really kind of unimpressed.
Yeah, I agree with you. I feel like the match was good. I feel like in a vacuum by itself, it would have been a great match. But the storyline was almost so good and the buildup was almost so intense that, like, nothing short of, like, the tag team ladder match, everyone's going to kill each other, would have satisfied me. I feel like it was almost like my expectations were so high for this match that there's literally nothing that could have lived up to them. And so I get it, and I feel like I absolutely agree with you. When I was watching it, I was like, I'm enjoying this. I like it. I think there are a lot of good things happening, but I don't love it. Looking back on it, though, like, that fucking finger on the rope as a, like, callback to the creation of Jericho, which I, like, didn't realize in that moment that that's what it was a callback to. It just felt like a good move, but now knowing that, it feels like an extra layer I'm tired of that.
From that, the latter half, the latter third of the match, I thought was really good. From, like, the finger moment on to, like, where they had a couple, like, turnovers, and then the pop-up powerbomb into the codebreaker, and then the, like, powerbomb into the apron. Like, the last half of the match, I thought was really good.
Yeah.
But just knowing Chris and Kevin's style and, like, how good of wrestlers they are, and then the strength of the storyline, it was just a little disappointing. I do hope that we get, like, a major payoff of it at Payback. Backlash. No, Payback.
No, you're wrong. You're right. That's the wrong one.
So
two words that mean the same thing. That's not confusing.
Right.
Raw SmackDown. We're doing it.
Doing it.
So I hope we get a bigger payoff, but you know, it wasn't the worst thing in the world, but like this, it's a case of the match. There was a couple matches, more than a couple actually on this card, I thought, where the storyline superseded the match. And I thought this was one of them.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. The build up was so much that this felt flat.
Yeah. And like the finger thing was great, but I feel like it's telling that this was a wrestling match and everyone's talking about, you know, Kevin Owens doing something funny with his finger.
Yeah, which is disappointing because they're so good. So the follow-up on Raw was that there was supposed to be a main event between Jericho and Seth versus Kevin and Samoa Joe. Jericho cuts a killer backstage promo, only like the GOAT could. He makes fun of the audience. He gets the shitty Raw audience on their side. Talks about beach ball mania, whatever.
Yeah.
I do hate that Raw and now SmackDown, because it's live, have started to normalize the shittiness of the crowd, which like...
Although I will say the SmackDown crowd was much less shitty than the Raw crowd.
And they were even less shitty for 205 Live than SmackDown, which is weird.
It feels like people who wanted to be there hung around on...
So he cuts a promo, but then, of course, Kevin Owens and Samoa Joe just beat the shit out of him because they're like, Kevin was like, stop talking. You think this is funny? Which I love. I mean, Kevin Owens, when he talks while wrestling or beating somebody up, it's like,
it's the best. It's pure gold.
But then, of course, Angle was like, you know, Seth, like, Jericho's not clear to wrestle. I don't know who you're going to get. I'll give you till the end of the show. I really hope you find somebody.
Right? We're all like,
I wonder who that somebody is.
We are ready.
Even knowing who it was going to be, it was great.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I loved it.
It was so good. It was so good.
I fucking love it. I'm so happy Finn's back. I'm so glad. He looked so happy. Honestly, one of my favorite moments of the show, no bullshit, is when Paul Heyman was talking. And the whole crowd, and everyone realized that he was talking about Roman being the 2 and 23 and 2. And the whole crowd so clearly, so in sync with each other was like, we want Baylor. I wonder what it was like for Finn to be backstage at that moment. And like, he was there. You know he was there. He came out later. Like, he was obviously backstage. What it's like to be backstage in that moment and hear everyone screaming over Paul Heyman that they want you there so badly. Like,
Paul Heyman is somebody that the crowd usually respects.
Yeah, exactly. And to hear them turn on him so harshly, like, we want fucking Baylor to face Brock Lesnar. And also, I loved in that moment that, this is a little jump ahead, but I love that Brock Lesnar had this look on his face like, who the fuck is Baylor? Like, bring that dude out. Like, oh, you want to see me fight Baylor? I'll fight Baylor. I don't want to fuck. Like, I love that. I thought that was
Baby
great.
Baby Shark will fight everybody.
Baby Shark also will fight everybody right now.
Like, I'm generally, you know, on the page, as I think we all are, that, like, it's shitty when the crowd just hijacks the show and says whatever they want that has nothing to do with what's going on in the ring. But I feel like that kind of moment, and we've seen this in the past, particularly in, like, the Daniel Bryan era and stuff, like, that kind of moment is when I feel like that is fully valid. When what's going on in the ring is, we are going to make this story about Roman Reigns.
Yes.
Like, chant about the wrestler you actually want to see.
Absolutely. And I felt like they did that too. I felt like Raw was focused in a way, the Raw crowd was focused in a way that they haven't been in a long time. When not Roman, that's not his name, Vince McMahon was out in the ring and was announcing the Superstar Shakeup, he paused and there was this moment where the whole crowd was like, Roman sucks. They just started chanting it at him, and he had this look on his face like, oh, fuck, I'm legitimately surprised you're doing this.
You guys, I have a new theory. What if Vince McMahon actually hates Roman Reigns, and he agrees with the audience that, like, one time Roman saved his life, and this is his life?
I feel like,
what?
Because, like, to see him react and be like, oh, is that how you really feel?
There's no other explanation.
It's insane. But I feel like that was a good moment of the crowd hijacking in the right way to be like, bitch, we're going to watch you listen to us.
Okay, I'm just going to throw this out there, and I'm going to say I don't think Roman Reigns secretly saved Vince McMahon's life.
What do you mean, Megan? It's the only thing that makes sense.
Well, here's the problem with that theory. That would require Vince.
Say it.
That would require Vince McMahon to have honor.
That's true.
That was
right.
Oh,
you
got it.
Okay. All right. What's the next match?
The next match is the Raw Women's Championship match. This is what my note says. Bailey slips, Nia struts, Sasha rise, Charlotte slays.
Okay, so during my illness, I was like in and out of consciousness during WrestleMania, and I was conscious at this point, and it was really fucking short. Am I right? So like
too short. The entrances were dope. It
was longer than I was expecting, to be honest. Like they
really like I am a Charlotte mark. And so I feel like, because I love her. And so, like, I feel like people on Twitter all the time are like, oh, well, you just want this to be Charlotte. And in this case, no.
Why is that a problem? Charlotte is dope.
Yeah, Charlotte is dope. She's
you. But, like, this was so short. Like, I don't really care. I'm not, like, that mad that Bailey won. Like, whatever. But I... Like, it felt like Nia was eliminated instantly, and then it felt like immediately after Nia was eliminated, Sasha was eliminated, and then I was like, oh, well, maybe this will turn into an amazing singles match. I should have known better. But, like it didn't, and then it was over, and I was like, oh, okay?
I don't know.
I just feel like it was super short.
Well, I haven't seen Kate's numbers at Make It Loud, but this match was like 11 or 12 minutes.
Yeah, something like that.
It was short, but I didn't feel like it was obnoxiously short. But I did feel like...
But for four people, it felt short.
Yeah, for four people, it was short.
Yeah. Sasha got eliminated too quickly. I definitely felt that. Like, I felt like getting Nia out pretty early by having everyone team up on her kind of made sense. But then when Sasha was gone so quickly after that, that's when I was like, this feels rushed.
Agreed. Like, yeah, the Nia thing made sense because they got to do the Shield moment. They got to do the, like, Super Friends moment. And, like, it made sense that it kept Nia's, like, integrity as a monster heel. Like, it took three women to take her out. Yeah. It was cool the way that they did it. But I agree. Once Sasha got out so quickly, it was like, oh.
Yeah, it felt very 1-2 that she got out. I totally agree with both of you. I think that it was a smart move in many ways to eliminate Nia with all three of them fresh at the beginning of the match. Like, it takes all of them fresh, unbruised, unbroken to eliminate Nia. I think that set up very good for her Monday retaliation against Charlotte, where it's like, a fresh Nia and a fresh Charlotte can really fuck each other up. And it felt like that was going to, like, I'm excited for that feud. I really want to see it. And so I understand how that was building up to it, but I agree that I think she should have been in the match longer. But at the same time, in hindsight, WrestleMania was 7.5 hours long. And it's like, they just overbooked this card.
You give a half an hour to Shane and
AJ. Oh, no. I totally agree. I 100% agree that, like, the way that they rationed out all this timing is fucked up, but at the same time, this card is also 7.5 fucking hours long, which is ridiculous. Like, although, they're gonna cut from the women, which blows, but is a thing that they do.
Although Sasha didn't heel turn, which is a disappointment, I did like that it ended with Charlotte and Bailey, because it really felt like that closed the chapter on Charlotte and Bailey.
Mm-hmm.
Bailey walking away with the title so that they could move on to other matches.
I just wish this had been where Bailey won the title.
I agree.
Yeah.
I still feel like that was booked badly. She did not need to have the belt until WrestleMania. It would have been such a bigger moment if she had won it here.
Though I would argue, I think Stella's right, but I think by making this the follow-up match where she beats Charlotte for the second time, they can move past this post-Mania. Whereas,
I mean, that's valid too.
Yeah,
like, I can see both ways. I agree that it would have been a much more powerful moment, and they're all about WrestleMania moments, if she had won it at Mania, but it does give... You know, Mania in a lot of ways is a reset button, like, for the year to come, so that they can get fresh feuds and fresh call-ups and things like that. So, although, like, I agree, I can see where they were coming from.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree.
But following night, Monday Night Raw, you know what's happening. Time, knee, gloves.
This is another one. I'm so excited.
It's one of
those happy
instances where I thought that the Monday after Raw match was really, like, way better than the Mania match. The Mania match I thought was good, but, you know, and I don't find myself saying this a lot by 3-on-3 matches, but this was great. It was really satisfying in many different ways.
I agree.
Yeah, I mean, I thought it was fine. I don't know. The biggest thing for me was Emma coming back. Not that the match was bad, but I was not, like, super focused on how,
not
like...
Not only did Emma come back, though, like, she had a great entrance. She jumped on the table, got into the commentator's face, but then Emma looked sick in the ring.
She did. She looked great. Dominated. I screamed, like, a lot.
She dominated. Like, she was in that match for probably at least half of it. She really took it to, like, the babyface team. And at the end, she had a great moment where, like, Nia was turning on Charlotte and Emma was like, I'm not a part of this. Bye. Like, it was great. I'm really curious to see where Emma ends up. I'm really happy to have her back. I'm really glad that she stood her ground and was like, fuck this Emelina bullshit. I know what I'm doing. I love Tiny Gloves Emma, and even though it's Tiny Gloves is mean, has no friend, I still love her.
Yeah, okay, so hold on. This is, like, only tangentially related, but can we, like, quash this really quick? I've seen a lot of people online being like, oh, well, Emma obviously just couldn't hack out being Emelina. Can we just talk about how it was a horrible idea, and she knew it was a horrible idea, so she said no?
Yeah, absolutely. Emma, I've heard that on our show before, for sure.
Emma is super hot. We all can agree on that, right?
Oh, yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
But Emma's also an incredible wrestler, and her heel gimmick was working before she got really injured. Why? Just because somebody gets injured, you don't always have to repackage somebody. Like, yeah, sometimes it makes sense and it moves the storyline along, but, like, it doesn't make sense for Emma. We've really moved past the age of, like, the Eva Marie, like, hot wrestler. Yeah. These women are incredibly hot, but that's not why I cheer for Charlotte. That's not why I cheer for Sasha. And it's sure as hell not why I cheer for Emma. Like, I cheer for them for these characters. I cheer for them for their wrestling ability. And, like, I cheer for them because I like to see something that they're comfortable doing. Naomi is a perfect example of that. Yes. Naomi has been on the roster for years, has struggled through so many gimmicks, and then they finally let her do this gimmick where she came up with it. She's like, I think this will work. It's totally me. And now she's over as fuck, and she's the SmackDown champ. Like, just trust your talent. And I think this is an example of, like, just trust your talent.
Yeah,
absolutely. I agree.
Also, Tiny Gloves, Emma's back. I love her. She's so good.
I was so excited that she kept her tiny gloves.
Yes, me too. Solomon.
I was like, what if she comes back and then it's like she doesn't have the gloves or she doesn't have this, but she still does.
Why do we love tiny gloves so much?
Because they're so
ridiculous. Because it's so ridiculous.
I have tiny gloves for one of my burlesque acts, and I've never thought about them before, but, like, I just have them because, like, aesthetically it works for this, like, rockabilly act, and now I'm like, no, tiny gloves are the best gloves. Those are burlesque, they're really dumb because, like, they take, like, half a second to take off, and you're like,
scoop!
So these are off. You're all acknowledging that these came off very quickly. But I'm very glad, and I liked the heel turn, or not the heel turn, because they're both heels, but I like that we're definitely setting up a Nia Charlotte feud.
Yes. Mm-hmm. 100% agree.
I don't know. I just thought it was a fun match. I can't wait for Summer Rae to come back. Do you guys like Summer Rae?
I like her as a character, but it's, like, one of those things where, like, I don't really want to watch her wrestle.
Fair.
Honestly, having only watched WWE for about 2 years, I feel like I've barely ever seen her wrestle.
That's fair.
Also, so I can't have much of an opinion on that. But I think she's a good performer, and I would like to see her get to do something.
Yes, I agree. I want her to do anything, honestly.
I like Summer a lot. I want her to come back.
I would be happy if she
ended up... She's not a bad wrestler.
I would be happy if she ended up in an Alicia Fox-type role, where it's like...
No, see, that would be so great for me, because when she was with Tyler Breeze...
Right, exactly.
Like, it was just like, oh, we're both really attractive people who are good at wearing clothes, and that made a lot of sense for me.
But Fandango and Tyler Breeze are also very attractive people who are good at wearing
clothes. Make them a staple.
Totally, totally.
Jealous. Make them a three-person staple. And shake it up. Superstar Shake-Up's happening next week. Send SmackDown. I'm down with that.
She's a part of the Fashion Police. I'm on board. Right?
Yes! Put her in white. The brave.
Okay, the next match is, in my opinion, match of the night. Obviously, it's the ladder tag match. So opens, Enzo and Cass come out, they do their whatever shit. You guys
Enzo and Cass!
You guys like...
I like Enzo and Cass, but I feel like after that Lana angle, I'm like a little bit sour.
Fuck that, yeah, that Lana angle was hot garbage!
I used to really like Enzo and Cass, and I would really like to like them again, but they need some rehab.
Oh, yes.
I've never liked them. I was happy when they got called up, but I've never really liked them. So I'm just like, whatever.
I've never really liked them without Carmella, to be completely honest.
Yes. Absolutely. That is
such, totally valid.
That's such a good point.
Yes.
And then it was fucking Cesaro coming out in their kilts. Here's
Magic
the thing.
Kilt.
I know a lot of people disagree with me, but like, Sheamus is hot as fuck. I don't care what
anybody. No, he is. He totally is.
He's super hot, especially with the mohawk. And Cesaro coming out, like, obviously, we talked about my love on your guys' podcast. We talked about my weird Scottish fetish. And I know kilts aren't only for Scotsmen, but like, a man in a kilt is like 100% my kryptonite. It is a 1,000% my kryptonite. So I was just like, these two super attractive men who I love coming out in kilts, coming out dressed as James Bond in kilts. Also, I'm a huge Bond fan. Like, I know it's problematic, whatever. I've been a huge Bond fan since I was little. So I was like, this is like the culmination of all of my fantasies. I am like living for this. So I thought it could not get better than that. And then the club comes out, whatever. And then the New Day comes out, and they're like, we're the New Day. There's the fourth team. La, la, la.
We're in our gear. We're going to wrestle.
We're going to be the
JK,
team.
JK,
JK. JK, it's the motherfucking Hardy Boys with a Z. I popped so hard.
I did too.
I did chicken arms, like my fingers under my armpits, and then I started crying, and I just went, is this real?
We were screaming. It was, okay, let me first set this scene. Stella had a party for WrestleMania, and there were like 20 people here at one
point.
There
were like 15.
No, there were like 20 people here at
one
point.
I'm so popular.
There were a lot of people, and I was like, first of all, who the fuck are all of these people? What the fuck is happening? And second of all, I cannot control how excited I am.
It was like half people who are really invested and half people who are just there to watch us yell at things.
Yeah, exactly. And so it was this like weird zoo experiment. And we were freaking out about the Hardy Boys. Bobby was there. He's been on the show before. But he like ran over and started hugging us, and we were like jumping up and down and screaming and crying. Like, oh my God, I can't believe they're actually here and this is really happening. And half of the people at this party were like, literally, what the hell is going on? So this is a very weird moment. Like, I love this match, but also at the same time, I was like, I need to explain to everyone what's happening and why this is amazing. And let me start 8 months ago when the Hardy Boys did this thing. I love it. I think it's amazing. It's amazing to me that WWE made this happen. Like, it's kind of incredible in a lot of ways.
It's even more amazing that the Hardys made this happen.
Yes, absolutely.
And good for them.
Yes.
Fucking really good for them. Yeah, it's a really nice moment on Raw Talk, which is dumb that I watched Raw Talk, but I did. Only because Renee was hosting it. But, you know, Matt Hardy's not really doing the broken gimmick because of the
lawsuit,
but he's, like, teasing it or whatever. But he had a really interesting line where he was like, you know, or Jerry Lawler, whatever, but he asked, you know, what makes this different? And Matt Hardy was like, you know, we've both been through a lot. We've both grown up. We've really settled into who we are. And like, you know, we're called the Hardy Boys, but like, we're like the Hardy Men now. We're adults and we're here to like, we're in the best like point of our careers and we're just here to have fun. We're here, we're home, we're here to have fun. And I was like, and then of course he was like, it's delightful. And I was like, yes, it is. And he's doing the broken gimmick a little. He's teasing it online. I think it's maybe arguably better that they came out as just the Hardy Boys and then like hopefully they'll like reintroduce the like broken gimmick.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say.
You know what? Whatever. I have like full blind faith in Matt Hardy. Like whatever Matt Hardy feels like he needs to do, like I am on board. I trust. He is somebody that made a video go viral of him staring into a camera making biting noises. So, like, I have faith in Matt Hardy.
Yeah. So, my experience of the Hardys is that I didn't know them, being a, you know, new fan and not watching TNA. And then the whole deletion thing happened, you know, when the first video came out last summer. And initially, I was like, I didn't care because I'm like, I don't watch TNA. I've never watched a Hardy Boys match. Why do I care? But then everyone just kept talking about how great it was. So eventually
You had to watch it.
I watched it and I was like, okay, this is fantastic. And then I watched like the first couple of follow-ups to it. And then just recently we watched Fully Loaded 2000 for one of our bonus episodes. Woo! So I finally saw, like, you know, an early WWE Hardy Boys match with Lita and everything. And I was like, okay, this is who the Hardys were before all of that stuff, you know, that they're doing now. And so then to see them come back to WWE and sort of be the Hardys from 2000 while also still being the Hardys, you know, from the final deletion, like, it really feels like watching everything come full circle.
Yeah, it feels. And then on Raw Talk, he also had a moment where he was like, this is, you know, the final stop in our expedition of gold, which, like, made sense. He's like, we've got the like main tag titles, like, we've done it, we're incredible. I'm really happy. They came out on Raw the night after. They fought the club. They got their rematch out of the way, which, like, I think it was smart to get out of the way.
I agree.
Also hilarious that the whole crowd chanted, fuck that owl.
Yes. Our friend Courtney Rose, Chicago C. Rose on Twitter, who's been on our podcast before, the guys behind her were the ones who started that chant. And they turned to each other right before they did it and went, it's time. And then started chanting, fuck that owl, and got everyone else to chant it, which makes it feel even more appropriate and perfect to me. So I just wanted to, like, put that out there. Anyway.
What were you going to say, Megan?
Oh, I was just going to do, like, my little bit of Hardy history, because we all have done hours about this match. So when I've always liked the Hardys, I've always found them super entertaining to watch, like, regardless of, like, their quote unquote technical ability, which I think they have a lot of, but I know they're kind of sloppier than some people, but, like, I always want to watch a Hardys match. Like, they never bore me, if that makes sense. When this deletion thing happened, I declared it the best angle of the year 2016, and I, like, personally bullied Elle Collins into watching it, and I think all of that was, like, correct. So, like, I was not technically conscious when this happened, but, like, I was asleep. I kept drifting in and out, and then I get woken up. I get shook by Nick, and he goes, Megan, the Hardy Boys just showed back up, and they won the WWE Tag Team titles. And I was like, what the fuck? And luckily, my computer, instead of restarting Mania, had paused it after the women's match. So I was just able to, like, fast forward to where the Hardys were. And I may or may not have cried.
I cried. It's legit.
I cannot confirm or deny, but I was like, they're back, and they're the champs, and the music is right, and everything is so good.
Objectively, it was a good match.
It was a really good match. That fucking diving swanton thing.
Off the ladder onto Cesaro onto another ladder. What the fuck?
I watched WrestleMania 17 this week, which, because I watched so much wrestling this week, I've just been, like, super hyped for it. But when Jeff Hardy did the swanton onto the tables, onto Rhino and the shitty Dudley, not Bubba Ray or Devon. They're, like, weird.
Yeah, the other one.
Yeah.
Spike.
Whatever. Yeah, Spike. Jeff Hardy also only hit one of those tables. Like, I think it's just hard to angle a swanton.
Yeah, I think you're probably.
Like, the move. It just looks weird when the other person has to, like, awkwardly get out of the frame after that.
Yeah, Rhino just, like, rolled off his table. Yeah. And just, like, under the other table at WrestleMania 17. But you know what? It's hard. Wrestling is hard. And Jeff Hardy is old, and he jumped off a huge ladder. Jeff Hardy is old and has children and jumped off of a huge ladder and swantoned onto ladders. So, like, true. Good on Jeff Hardy.
Jeff Hardy wanted to retire a year and a half ago and came back because Matt asked him to because of the broken gimmick.
Matt was like, I got this whole thing. I'm going to talk to giraffes. It's going to be good.
It's going
to
be.
But in, like, a weird turn of events, I feel like them going back to WWE is, like, a Jeff thing.
No, I don't think so.
I heard, like, via the dirt sheets, which, as Elle knows, I'm a big viewer of, that because of how his time ended with WWE being riddled with, you know, drugs and inconsistency, that it was really important to him to go back and to do WWE run. I don't know if that's true. Again, this is just dirt sheets, but I heard that it was, like, very motivated by, like, Jeff's feelings.
Well, I feel like part of it is that I also know from dirt sheets, digging, because that's a thing that I really like, and also because I listen to a lot of podcasts about, like, dirt sheet-y material. I'm into that kind of stuff. Jeff talked like a year and a half ago about how he legitimately wanted to retire and was like, I'm kind of, he broke his leg and was like, I really think I'm done after this. This isn't something I'm interested in. And Matt was the one who really came up with the broken gimmick. And I think it was, yes, Jeff really wanted those moments with WrestleMania. And yes, this is
the first time Jeff Hardy's won at WrestleMania.
Yeah, I think that's really important. But I also think with Matt, like, WWE said explicitly several times over the last couple of years that they would never rehire Matt Hardy because he had so many problems with Lita and they had so many fucked up problems with their relationship. And Lita was very involved in their creative process. She was a writer. She was part of the creative staff for a long time. She was a host. She was the woman who reintroduced the women's division. Like, WWE as an entity is fucked up and weird. And so they're like, yeah. Lita, we don't ever need to bring Matt Hardy back. But now they can't deny that Matt Hardy is the one who made this gimmick and who made this good. And they're like, well, we want this from Jeff because we love him and we've always LOL loved Jeff. But I think now is really the only time that WWE has ever been like, Matt, we respect you. You've come up with something that's legitimately
also, it's
the
Matt.
Best.
Yeah, like, Matt got all of this over.
It is so Matt. It is so Matt to the core, and I feel like WWE is recognizing this, and I think because of that, Matt is like, I want this. I want WWE to recognize me, and I think
the
only reason Jeff is doing this from the beginning is because Matt asked him to. Jeff wanted to retire. And
that's
like,
fair. No, you're right. You're right. I just thought that this turn to WWE might have been Jeff, but you're kind of confused.
Yeah, I totally get it. I think it is both. I think it's more Matt, but I totally think it's both.
No, because this gimmick, I mean, you can see in like the very first like broken skit where like Jeff literally rolls his eyes at a few like, points and you're just like, okay, like Matt wrote all of this.
Yeah, Jeff didn't commit for so long and Matt was like, bitch, commit! I got this! And it worked. Totally worked.
So I got curious and did a little research because you were talking about Jeff Hardy being old.
He is old.
Is he not that old?
Well, I'm not going to say he's not old. He's 2 years older than me. And basically in wrestling, if you're older than me, you're kind of old.
Well, Jeff's also been wrestling since he was like 12. So
right. Yeah. But specifically the thing I wanted to say about his age is that Jeff Hardy, AJ Styles, John Cena, and Brock Lesnar are all exactly the same age.
And Brock Lesnar are the same age?
They're weird. All going to turn 40 this year. All 40.
Brock Lesnar, both simultaneously, looks like a baby and looks like he's about to die.
Girl, preach. Preach that Brock Lesnar truth.
Oh, my God.
Okay, let's move on.
We have so many matches to talk about.
The next match was the mixed tag match with Miz and Maryse versus Nikki Bella. All I gotta say is Miz and Maryse look bomb.
Yeah.
Yes.
Miz and Maryse know how to make an entrance.
Yes,
they looked awesome. This match was super fun, and John Cena and Nikki Bella got engaged, and it was the best of the night. Okay, the end.
Tried hard.
This, for me, was one of the matches where the storyline was better than the match, but knowing objectively that Nikki got hurt right before this and that her neck was really messing or like acting up, like it made sense that there was not a lot of Nikki Maryse action. I was a little disappointed by that because I did really want to see Maryse wrestle, because Maryse was never the best wrestler, but she was never like a tragic Eva Marie wrestler. I actually have gone back and watched several Maryse matches lately, and like they were very indicative of the diva era, but they were also, she also is very athletic, and her character work has been top notch from the beginning. So I was a little disappointed by that, but I did like how strong Miz looked against John Cena, and I liked how Nikki basically had to save John Cena. So that was
me too. I totally agree with that.
And it was nice to have their like, you know, five knuckle shuffle couple, you know, AA into the STFU or whatever, or STF. Can't say FU.
Whatever.
John Cena's for children.
Oh, yeah.
Don't swear at children. So I thought it was a really fun match, but I was a little disappointed, which is, you know, par for the course. But I think even if the match was disappointing, the engagement was very sweet. And even though a lot of people expected it or knew about it, it was still really nice.
Yeah.
And that rock.
Yeah.
If you go on the Bella's, if you go on the Bella's YouTube page, which I am a subscribed member to,
I'm subscribed.
Right, it's a great channel. It's terrible and wonderful. There's a video with
Love Bella Brains.
The Bellas are the best. There's a video with John Cena and Nikki Bella explaining the like significance of the ring, and it's super corny but actually really sweet.
I ended up explaining to someone who doesn't watch wrestling on Twitter why the public proposal didn't bother anybody, because he was like, you know, having seen the clip or whatever going around, he was like, where are all the people that always have takes about how public proposals are bad? And I was like, okay, first of all, everyone knows wrestling is fake. And like, this was set up from the beginning. Like, it's not like they're not engaged, but it's also like there was any chance that Nikki Bella didn't know this was going to happen.
Exactly. Absolutely.
And secondly, like, the other reason, in addition to like the way that it puts pressure on the woman, the other reason that many people, including me, frequently object to public proposals is that often it's like stealing a moment.
Yes.
This was an entire moment that was set up, that was created to host this proposal.
Absolutely. 100%. I also feel like I had a similar thing. My sister, who does not watch any wrestling at
Which
all.
Which sister?
Megan.
Okay.
She's like 13 months younger than me. She's like basically my twin. She has never watched any wrestling in her life. She's one of the reasons I did not watch wrestling as a child after I abandoned it. I was like embarrassed because my sister hated it. So I didn't watch it because of her. And she's like very supportive now. She and her husband both are like, we love you. You're so great. This is wonderful that you do this thing. We don't get it, but it's fine. So she sent me, she didn't text me. She texted me on Twitter basically and was like, I felt like this was really obvious that this woman, who I have no idea who she is, knew that this man was proposing. Is it scripted? I don't understand. Erin, please tell me the facts. And I was like, okay, Megan, here we go. Megan is also my sister's name. Megan, here we go. And so we talked about it, and I was like, you know, it's part of the fact that it's storyline-based, that there's a lot of backstory, that there's a lot of things outside of just the wrestling that contribute to this, and also they probably had a private proposal, which everyone kind of knows. Like, I think the smarks who are going to be pissed about the fact that this happened and it was a moment already know they had a moment. This already happened in private. They already did this. This isn't like Nikki knew this was going to happen. It was like, this already happened. We already know. She just has decided not to wear the ring. And also, this thing that's very important to me, which was very hard to explain to my sister, but I think is very important in this moment. Undertaker, who is a huge part of WWE, wanted his final match to be with Cena. And Cena gave up Taker's retirement match to do this mixed tag with Nikki, which, like, everybody says this shit about Cena, and I say shit about Cena. I think Cena is shit in a lot of ways because he has a lot of weird OCD things, as I have, and I understand, and the 75-page contract and all the things that Miz and Maurice make fun of. But Cena gave up a huge opportunity. Taker came out on SmackDown and announced that that's where he was going to come out and make a move because of Cena. Like, Cena was the trajectory. Thank you. I was like, I'm too drunk to make this word come out of my mouth. The trajectory for this match. Like, Cena was the person who was supposed to be the person who faced Taker, and he chose Nikki. And that, I think that's
really important. I have a question.
Yes.
Is that what happened? Because I heard, again, on the dirt sheets,
yes,
that Vince was like, no, you have to wrestle Roman.
Oh, I heard that Cena made this decision he was like, I have to retire.
That's way better. I want to go with that. I just had not heard that.
Yeah. Also, if there's anything that, like, smarks are going to make up and push so hard that it ends up in a dirt sheet, it's Vince pushing Roman.
Exactly. No, that's totally fair. That's just not what I had heard. I like this way better.
I'm seen as like the one person that can be like, no, Vince.
Exactly.
No, this is way better. Way better. I'm in full support of this.
And the fact that that Taker originally came out and Cena is like a good push to that idea that like this is where this was really supposed to go. Like, why would this have happened if Cena wasn't originally supposed to be the mark? And like, as much as Vince wants to jizz all over Roman, like, Cena is his dude. Like, Cena has always been his dude. Cena is the guy who makes money. Cena is the guy who, like, really produces product in a way that even Roman does not. So I think that, like, that idea is what... And, like, that has been the rumor for a year, that Cena and Roman, Cena and Taker were supposed to be the match. And so to have Cena turn this down, it's kind of amazing. Like, Cena is viewed as this dude who, like, shits all over everyone and takes everybody's spot. To, like, pick this up for Nikki is, like, really incredible. It makes me feel a totally different way about this match.
The other thing that really wins me over to John Cena in this situation is that he, because he's Vince's dude and he, you know, can do whatever he wants and has all this pull in the company, he clearly is okay with what Miz has been doing and saying about him. And like the fact, like he, what Miz says and the way that Miz makes fun of him when he imitates him is so spot on and so biting. Oh, the fact that Cena can like look at that and say, hey, you got me. You know, this is.
The fact that Miz walks around with his like ass sticking out, like, is hilarious. The, like,
straight arm, weird 90 degree angle run thing. It's so good.
John's recognized. Which leads into SmackDown really well. Like, John Cena, so Nikki can't wrestle right now. John Cena's off doing a movie. I like that they didn't have them come out and be like, we're not going to be around for a while. They just kind of disappeared after their like engagement, which makes sense. Like, they're off
kayfabe,
planning their wedding, real life planning their wedding, whatever. Having Miz and Maryse come out and do their hilarious rendition of Nikki and Cena and, you know, go full Miz and Maryse. And then to be interrupted by Shinsuke, like,
perfect.
It was kind of, it was like a weird, seamless transition. And that violin is the best.
Oh my God, so good.
And his face when he was, excuse me, Miz, I have to play the violin now.
I thought what was going to happen, and it's a relief that they did that this didn't happen, because WWE is bad at accidentally making stuff seem racist, and this could have happened here. But I thought Shinsuke was going to come out and challenge John Cena, and then Miz was going to be like, I'm not John Cena, I'm the Miz. And Shinsuke was going to be like, I don't care, I'll beat up you instead.
I can see that.
That would have been good, too. That would have worked into
I would have been fine with that.
That would have worked into his, like, weirdo factor.
Yeah, I feel like he's a weirdo enough that it would have worked. I also feel like it was the perfect moment. We sort of talked about this on your guys' show, but I feel like it's the perfect moment for Shinsuke, because Miz is so good on the mic that if they have a feud, Shinsuke doesn't necessarily need to talk. He can just be a badass who beats ass, and he feels like the right person to come out for this. Also, if Miz imitates Shinsuke in his costume, I will die. I might actually just die right in my seat. I think that would be incredible, and I would really.
I have such like a level of respect for Maryse. Like, she is actually really fucking funny.
She is really funny.
Her Nikki Bella is on point on a next level, which it's like almost shocking. It's
the way that she moves her face when she's Nikki Bella is so like spot on.
It's so calculated. I love it.
It's so spot on.
What's happening next?
It's the non-sanctioned match between Triple H and Seth Rollins.
So, first of all, being bikers who are accompanied by police officers is the most Triple H and Steph entrance possible. It's like, we're badasses who are also rich Republicans.
Right?
Yeah.
I also love that it followed the power couple match, because it was like, who's the real power couple? And then Steph and Triple H were like, we are.
Bitch, we are.
Okay, I do want to say I really liked this match.
I agree. I like this match. It felt like 5 minutes too long.
Yeah.
Like, it was a little too long, but I actually really enjoyed this match.
I feel like all Triple H matches feel too long now.
That's too true.
That's totally a Triple H thing, because Triple H just does the Bobby Roode thing of, like, he's going not to waste necessarily, but he's going to spend more time like doing character stuff than actual wrestling, which is why all of his fucking matches are like 15 minutes long or longer. I don't know. I really like this match. I did think it was too long, especially considering some other things that were happening on this card, which maybe deserved more time.
Yeah.
But Seth Rollins and Triple H are both really great wrestlers, and I have been excited about this match from the get-go. I was so stoked that Seth Rollins remembered how to do flips. I don't know if you guys have heard my fucking tirade about Seth Rollins and how he's not a power wrestler, but yeah. And how I think that's why he's been getting hurt more. But I mean, he did like three flips and I was like, what the fuck? I was so hype. Yeah, it was too long. Most Triple H matches are, but like Triple H is really good at wrestling and Seth Rollins is really good at wrestling. And I thought that it was a great match.
Also, never bring Stephanie McMahon to the ring. She's gonna get fucked up.
Right.
Yeah, okay. Like everyone was like, people were like, "Oh my god, a surprise bump to Stephanie," and I'm like, "What? Surprise. In what world?" Besides the fact that it was obviously set up. Like even if we're ignoring that, like historically, she takes bumps at big matches.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Like what?
Yeah. It was a good bump though.
The table was gimmicked.
Triple H's response to it was good, and how it was like, whoa, I almost did it. Oh, psych, I did it. Like, I thought that was effective.
No, it was. It was.
Also, Seth Rollins needs to stop doing the pedigree. Now that he's officially put Triple H away.
His pedigree sucks. He's bad at it, but he's also too small for it.
Yeah, like, it doesn't fit his character anymore. Now that he's, like, defeated Triple H, like, he should do the Falcon Arrow. He should do something else.
Yeah. He's not great at it. He's too small for it. I think the pedigree, like, aesthetically looks best if you are a bigger guy doing it onto someone smaller than you.
If you're Triple H. Yeah.
Pretty much. It's kind of just a Triple H thing. And, like, you're right. Like, I've heard the story. Like, he's told the story about, like, how Vince won't let him do the curb stomp anymore. And while I personally think that sucks because I love the curb stomp, he has a lot of other options open to him.
Yeah, like, Seth Rollins is a great wrestler.
He does not have to be doing the pedigree. He's bad at it, and you're right. I hope that now that he's beaten Triple H, he doesn't have to do it anymore.
Right. The following night on Raw, Vince McMahon came out and did his Vince McMahon walk and addressed the crowd and thanked them, but then was like, my daughter Stephanie is really hurt. And then the whole crowd cheered. He was like, no, they're really hurt. They're like,
very yeah. cool.
Which is like such a classic Vince McMahon thing. But that's also when he introduced the SmackDown shakeup. And it was also when he introduced Kurt Angle. He was like, well, Stephanie's out and Mick Foley's been fired. So I got to bring out a new GM. And then of course, Teddy Long comes out. And it's like, hey, hello.
And I thought that was so funny though. Because Vince was like, it's not you, Teddy. And he was like, oh, okay.
Vince was so pissed. He was like, honestly, like, please leave. Teddy Long had an R-Truth moment of like a, my bad.
They did the same thing.
Funny. Like, it would have been rude, but because Teddy Long was so good natured about it, I thought that it was really funny.
Well, they did the exact same thing.
During the draft.
They were talking to all the different people about potentially running SmackDown. Like, he showed up during that, and they did the same. No, it's not you, Teddy. And, like, I like that that's kind of his gimmick now.
That's his new thing. I'm all in on Teddy showing up all the time and everyone being like, literally, please leave.
Yeah.
But then we got introduced to Angle, and Angle came out. I love how good of a sport Angle is when the crowd chants you suck. Like, it's all in good fun.
Yeah.
And Angle is going to be a really fun GM.
Yes.
The You Suck chant is in the same way as the Cena Sucks chant, it's a really good example of the crowd showing affection to a wrestler, where it's not like, you actually suck. It's like, we've made this bond with you.
It's part of the canon.
Exactly. We like, do this. I think Miz was a great example of that. When he came out as Cena, people immediately were like, Cena sucks.
Oh,
and when they realized...
We did not talk about the moment where Miz was like, John Cena uses these hand towels to clean up jizz.
Yeah, that was no. But he came out and was like, as soon, like, it was like a wall that hit. People were like, oh, you're not Cena? We don't want to chant this. Not because you're not good, but because this isn't an intimate bond that we share with you. Like, it's a wrestler audience experience where, like, oh, you're not John Cena? We're doing this to let you know, in the same way as the Kurt Angle, you suck. Which is why I think he was a very appropriate person to induct him into the Hall of Fame. Like, he has that same kind of heat where it's like, we chant this thing at you where we hate you, quote, unquote, unquote, unquote. But it's actually like, we love you. We want this. You need to recognize that we connect to you in this way. I think also in that way, he's very different from Roman, where people boo the idea of Roman. Like, the moment Roman appears on a screen, people boo him. But if it's like not real Cena, people don't want to chant Cena sucks, because it's an intimate relationship with Cena where it's like, we connect with you absolutely directly. We want to let you know that we recognize you as a person. Whereas Roman is just like, we want to boo you because fuck the direction that you're going. So I think it's very
interesting. This weekend made me think about how, in probably only like 10 years or so, when Cena gets inducted into the Hall of Fame, the crowd is going to chant along with his music, John Cena sucks, and they're going to grin, and he's going to grin, and it's, you know, it's just part of the thing now, like you said.
Yeah, absolutely.
John Cena sucks. Sorry, now I have it stuck in my head. But yeah, absolutely. It was really fun. Also, I'm just going to circle back because there's like no other point where we're going to talk about it. I meant to talk about it with Shinsuke Nakamura, but we got Shinsuke Nakamura called up to the SmackDown roster, but we also got Ty Dillinger called up.
Yes.
Which was, in a word, a perfect 10.
That's yes.
Three good words. But in three words, was a perfect,
perfect 10.
I love that he came out and squashed Kerr Hawkins. Like, Kerr Hawkins was like, what? It's all about me. And Ty was like, no. It's not. I'm very happy for Ty to come up. I'm very excited to see
him.
Me too.
So I'm very interested to hear about your thoughts about this match, because I know one of you, Megan, is a Randy Orton mark. The next match was the WWE Championship, Randy Orton versus Bray Wyatt.
Okay, hold on. I want to defend my honor a little bit. I'm not necessarily a Randy Orton mark.
I'm just
an RKO mark. I love that move so much. I just want him to do that move on everyone. But I'm conflicted because I love Bray Wyatt. So this match...
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
This match was hard because, like, I feel like for so long
it was bad, right? Can we just say
that too?
Yeah,
I thought that the silly projection special effects were all actually pretty awesome, but they should have led to Bray winning.
I thought they were cool if Bray won, but the one thing that really took away from them is the way that the refs screwed out each time. Like, I can't be in the bugs. That really took out the magic out of it.
I think after all of this really intense buildup that they've been doing towards Bray and Randy, to have this be like the end, quote unquote, was really disappointing, and I thought it was bad, like straight up. Like, I didn't, this match did not have the care that an angle that had this much buildup to it should have had.
Wyatt should have won. I don't get it. I literally, from the moment Bray Wyatt has come up to the main roster, I do not understand his booking. I really don't fucking get it. Because they give him a lot of screen time, and they give him a lot of promo time, and they let him develop his character, and then they book him like a fucking, like, loser. I don't fucking get it. Like, how is this mystical force of the devil supposed to be taken out by an RKO? Like, that shouldn't work. That shouldn't fucking work. I hope that there's some payoff with this House of Horrors match, but like...
I did kind of pop for that when I was watching SmackDown. I was like, what the fuck is a House of Horrors match? Like, what the fuck is that?
Like a lunatic fringe match or whatever. It's just going to be corny. It's just going to be a street fight.
I really hated that he rejoined with Eric Rowan.
Me too.
On SmackDown, because like, okay, I get it. What the hell else are you going to do with Eric Rowan? But I feel like part of the problem with Bray, I mean, there's been many problems with how Bray has been booked, but they keep being like, he has a family, now he doesn't have a family, oops, now he has a family again. Like, they just broke him up with Luke Harper, and now he's got a guy again. Like, maybe let him not have a guy for a while.
Yeah, it really sucks, because I feel like it's a testament to the, like, actor that is Bray Wyatt, that he has been able to carry this character and carry this storyline for so many years with such horrible booking. Like, the audience still loves him. Like, we're all still wanting Bray Wyatt to succeed. The phones light up. There are fireflies everywhere. We're always on board for Bray Wyatt, even though this match even though the booking's so horrible, which may be to his detriment, honestly, because, like, we're always over for him, even when he loses and loses and loses and loses. But, like, it's a testament to how good the actor of Bray Wyatt is. But it just is, like, as a fan, and as a fan of Bray Wyatt, and as a fan of wrestling, and as a fan of, like, mystical shit, like, it's just disappointing. Like, it's just disappointing.
Yeah.
And it doesn't make any sense.
I agree.
Yeah. Bingo. I'm a huge Bray Wyatt mark because I'm like a recovering goth. And so,
I mean, aren't we all?
Recover, Megan.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I still own like four different black lipsticks. I don't think I'm free. I'm a huge fan of Bray Wyatt, and I have been like ever since I like found out who Bray Wyatt was. I don't really know about him on NXT. I don't. But, like, I think he's great, and so I want him to win. And, like, people are always, like last year when he had that segment with The Rock, I saw this thing on Twitter where, like, it was him with The Rock and him with Taker and some other old legends, and they're like, it really says something about Bray Wyatt that all, like, the legends want to work with him, that says he's a good worker. And I'm like, okay, but, like, so fucking what? Like, honestly, that amounts to nothing. Like, great, having backstage respect is awesome, but like that doesn't like you have to win at some point to like matter in the year 2017. And I thought that maybe him winning the winning the WWE championship was going to signify like the start of him maybe mattering.
Yeah, but era of Wyatt, but then they just squashed it for the
exactly. Era. It's gone again, and so now I really don't know how to feel.
Yeah,
it sucks.
Also, and I've said this before on our podcast, but I cared about Randy Orton for exactly as long as he was a Wyatt.
Yeah,
that's the only time I've ever cared about Randy Orton.
Me too. Also, Randy Orton kind of looks like my dad, and always creeps me out. It's like a little creepy for me personally.
I get that.
He looks like my dad. I did.
Looks like how Elle can't like crop tops on men because of her father.
Yeah, it's just weird. There's Brock Lesnar and Goldberg. Here are the three things that I'll say about it. It was way better than I thought it would be. It was exactly what it should have been from the beginning. And although I am mad that Brock has the title, I'm ready for Goldberg to be gone.
I agree with all that.
Okay, I don't. It was way better than I thought it would be. I don't like that Goldberg lost, not because, I don't know. I think that it's like really poor timing to like take the belt off the Jewish superhero and give it to some like Aryan super monster.
Fair.
Yeah.
Lesnar went out and was like, I don't want to be here. So like but that.
Here's the problem. Here's the fucking problem though. He has the belt. Like that was my whole, like, that was the reason I was pissed off that, like, Goldberg got the belt. It's not that I need Goldberg to stick around. It's that I don't think that gay for Lesnar, but, like, that means everyone's gay for Lesnar. Not everyone, but, you know, like, the general audience, I feel like, is super to Lesnar. But, like, but that's just the thing, though. Like, he doesn't need the belt. He doesn't need the belt. Like, why was the belt involved here? I'm pissed that a part-timer has the belt. I don't know. I think this was bad.
Well, Goldberg was a part-timer too, though. I think what's going to happen is Lesnar's going to face Roman. Roman's going to win. And then Lesnar will hopefully disappear forever, which won't happen. But, like, one can pray. Hopefully, we can get Roman versus Finn and Roman versus other people. Like,
that's fine.
I don't
love
Roman Reigns, but I am fine with Roman as the champ. I'm fine. I really am. I've like accepted Roman and I'm fine with him. If they want him to get to the championship picture, just let him be the champ. Just let him be the shitty guy that has the like shitty guy that we all love to hate that has the belt, right? Whatever. Who cares? So I'm hoping that we can just expedite Roman getting the belt so that we can get other people having the belt. But I was overall like okay with this match.
Yeah, fair? I think I was less okay with it than most people, but I get your reasoning, if that makes sense. Like, I agree with you. I think that Brock will not have the belt for any extended period of time. So I think that this kind of ends up being inconsequential, but at the same time, like, why? I don't know. It just frustrates me on this level that I can't really, like, get to the bottom of, if that makes sense.
I get where you're coming from. It's just like a weird situation that they put us in that where we're like, we have to choose between Brock and Goldberg.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
I think, like, I didn't like Brock beating Goldberg. I certainly don't like Brock having the belt. I didn't love Goldberg having the belt either. But I can't really object to Brock defeating Goldberg just because I've been resigning myself to it since the first time Goldberg beat Brock.
Yeah.
Like, we all knew exactly
where it was going to end. But for the ending match, it was, for them specifically, I wasn't disappointed by the match. It was like...
No, I wasn't either. This was way more entertaining than, like...
Right.
I was impressed that Goldberg took Germans.
Germans are sexy. Even if Brock, the grossest baby shark, is doing it.
Oh my god, he does look like a weird baby shark, right?
Shark.
It's so uncomfortable.
Literally,
he's so pink. He's
anybody so pink. In the entire world over Brock Lesnar. I'm putting that out.
Me too. We've already talked about this, but me too.
Let's talk about an entire match where everyone in the match is not only beautiful, but very talented. The SmackDown Women's Championship. So everyone had truncated entrances except for Naomi, which makes sense. It was late in the show. They clearly kind of booked it as a cool down, which is stupid for them because people were hyped for this match. Naomi's entrance was dope. I am such a mark for Naomi. The only wrestling sign I've ever made for Naomi. I love Naomi. You know, they did this weird thing all night where, like, the champions in mini matches were entering first, which they did with Alexa. It was super weird. But it worked because Naomi needed the, like, big entrance. My overall thought of the match was it was short, but everyone got a moment, and Naomi's new submission is super dope, and it was really important for Naomi to pin the champ or submit the champ to win the belt.
Yep.
Glow time, baby.
I'm really glad Naomi won. I was super bummed when she had to give it up.
Yeah.
You're right. This was like kind of a little bit truncated, but I think the ending was perfect. And I can't really complain about this.
I think I'm absolutely not minimizing the way that women are minimized at WWE and the fact that that's a problem, because that's all 100% accurate. But I also think, like, at this point in the night, it was so goddamn late that anybody... Like, any match that didn't involve a McMahon or Roman Reigns was gonna get cut fucking short.
Yeah, which is fair. But the women in this match made the most of it, I thought.
They absolutely did. Everyone had great moments. There were some weird fucking clothes.
Yeah. So, apparently Mickie James is Native, which, like, okay, but, like, nobody was prepared for that.
Well, okay. So, I have something I need to say about that.
Okay, please go for it.
Because we all were initially sort of like aghast that she came out wearing a headdress and a like dream catcher on her gear. And then people were like, wait, she's Native American. It's fine. And we were all, you know, all of us woke white people were sort of like, okay, she's Native American. It's fine. But I specifically wanted to mention, just because I think this voice is worth hearing, how even secondhand, my friend James Leesk, who is Native American and who has written a lot about indigenous representation, specifically in comics, which is how I know him. We worked together at the now defunct Comics Alliance. He responded to me on Twitter when this was being discussed and said, you know, it's actually a lot more complicated than that. Like, yes, Mickie James has Native American heritage or says that she does, but the way that she interacts with like Native iconography, like the headdress and the dreamcatcher and so forth, is a very like traditionally white kind of way of doing that, where it's not like she's actually wearing things that resemble what her ancestors from like the Powhatan tribe, which is the tribe that she says she has heritage from, actually wear. It's just sort of like
random.
I get to wear Indian stuff because I'm an Indian or whatever. And it's really like there's really a way in which that's still not really cool.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. It did feel like, oh, I'm Native, so it's fine that I wear this, like, generic headdress.
Yeah.
I'm not Native, but because, like, on her Instagram, because I follow everybody on Instagram, she was like, oh, I'm so proud to be repping my, like, Native heritage tonight. And I'm like, okay, but I don't know. It didn't feel genuine. I cannot comment on like the specificity of like different indigenous tribes. Like, that's not my place, but it did not feel genuine. Also, if we're talking about clothes in general, Becky Lynch looked like shit.
What the fuck was Becky Lynch
and,
doing?
And, like, Becky never looks like shit. But, like, she looked like shit.
Her gear shit together. Because, like, Sasha, like, she'll change the colors, but it's the gear. Bailey, the same thing. Charlotte, the same thing. Nia, the same thing. Becky just throws on clothes, and it's always bothered me. And I'm a huge Becky mark. It's always bothered me. Apparently, Becky was cosplaying some video game, which, like, if you played this video game, you, like, marked out for. But if you didn't play this video game, it just looked like an Irish girl with reds. And then somebody would come for you, like, well, read your lore, like, in native Irish heritage, the Vikings had dreads or, like, whatever. But, like, it is a really hot button issue. And it's also, like, also, there was a video posted of them taking out their dreads. So it was like, so you just dreaded your hair for one day? That is the most ignorant white thing to ever do.
Yeah, and
that's not what dreads are for.
So I heard the thing that she was cosplaying a video game character too, but I Googled that video game character and I do not see it.
Yeah, I kind of see it, but not really. And like, it was just disappointing.
Yeah, I hope that it's not an ongoing, like, I hope that's not her new gimmick. I hope that was just a weird thing.
There's a video of Rhino and Renee Young taking out her dreads. So
yeah, I saw that too, and it was great.
It was great. But, you know, I mean, if there's a silver lining of it, it's that, like, a black female won the title, and it seems like she's going to keep the title for a while.
100%. 100%.
Yeah. Also, like,
with all the misguided action, not that that makes up or excuses, like, the misguided actions, but it's like, okay, like a black woman has this, like, the title now. Like,
all three of the champions or the women champions are women of color right now.
Yeah, because isn't Bailey Hispanic?
Yeah, Bailey is Latina.
That's, yeah, and obviously Asuka's Asian.
Obviously, she's from Japan, Megan.
Okay, you know what?
She was, like, actually from Japan.
Yeah.
You know, it's weird because the SmackDown women's title also felt like they did this SmackDown any available woman because they didn't know what was going to happen with Naomi. But I felt like they kind of made up for it on SmackDown Live because that match between her and Alexa was fire. It was really good. It kind of felt like this is the match we wanted to have at WrestleMania, but we weren't sure we were going to be able to have it. So we're giving it to you now.
Yeah, totally.
I love Naomi's new submission. I love that she... I think the heels and heels said it. That's like you put something into submission. It's like, no, you're gonna look in my eyes when you tap out.
Yeah, I didn't get the submission at first because of like the angle when she first did it. I was like, wait, she just has her arm around her neck. How is that? Oh my god, her arms are between her legs.
Yeah, I thought it was dope. Also, like, I watched Naomi on Raw Talk, and like, I can't help but smile when Naomi is talking. Like, I'm so happy for her. I'm just like, such a huge Naomi mark. Like, she seems like such a genuinely good person who's like worked her ass off, who's really talented in the ring, who's always trying new stuff, who has a dope entrance. Like, literally, what is there not to love about Naomi? I love her.
I agree. She's also, I mean, aren't they all, but she's gorgeous.
We made a joke early in the night at WrestleMania. We were like, oh yeah, we just want to see Naomi twerk down the runway. And then she hit her like slide and then literally just like twerked on the runway, and we were like, yes, that is literally all we wanted. Yes, yes, Naomi, please twerk down the runway. Cause her ass is made out of magic.
It's true.
Best ass in the thing. Like, Renee was really funny on on Raw Talk, where she was like, you gotta tell me about that move. And Naomi was like, I was just in the moment, I didn't know, I was just dancing. She was like, I got a little heat from my husband, you know. And she was like, yeah, I mean, I understand that. Renee said, like, yeah, I understand that. That's a precious commodity there. Like, but it's just you and Naomi having a moment talking about how wonderful her butt is.
Like, I love imagining in the like kayfabe version of Naomi's marriage where Jimmy Uso talks the way that he talks in kayfabe now.
Yeah, but she's like a good guy and he's like a bad guy, but like kind of a good guy. Like, people really love the Usos right now.
Yeah, and I love the idea that like when he's like chiding her for twerking down the runway, he calls her Us.
Yeah, I love the idea of him just calling her Us. That's really funny. I've never thought about that, and now it's the only thing I'm ever going to think of when I think of their relationship. Okay, we've gotten to the most depressing part and the end of our podcast. Roman Reigns versus The Undertaker in what is presumed to be his retirement match. Yeah, I feel like that big sigh is a perfect expression of this.
The Undertaker is my favorite wrestler. Point blank. He is my favorite. And I read that interview he gave a couple months ago where he was like, I know it's time to hang up the boots when somebody is in the audience and they say to their son, oh, The Undertaker's here. I wish you could have seen him when he was like this. And he's like, and I feel like that's about to be me, and that's why I want to give up the boots. And it's just like, you should have given up like 3 years ago then.
Should have given right? up. Period. Like it's...
Because I feel like for the past 2 years, I guess, maybe three at this point, I'm bad at time, he has been wrestling really subpar matches where every time we've all been like, he looks so old.
Yeah.
And he looked so old in this match.
It's just sad. The end, if you go back to WrestleMania 30, the way that Taker walks out of Mania... It felt like a retirement. It really did. Like, Brock broke his streak, and the way he walked out felt like a retirement. And then they kept trotting him back out, which was, like, such a mistake.
Yeah, yeah.
This match, like, in my opinion, Undertaker hasn't had a good match since Cena, or not Cena, CM Punk versus Taker. Like, that was his last
good match. I agree. That was my favorite. That's, like, my favorite recent Taker match.
Brock was, like... shocking, and it was a good match because it was like so upsetting, like it made the point, but anything after that has been a mess, and it like sucked. Like I felt really bad for Roman because Roman, like, all feelings about Roman aside, like him taking out Taker like that just like it felt like it plummeted his stock and not made it better.
Yeah, I think
like, oh, this is my yard now. It felt like I just murdered a dog in front of you. Like an old dog.
I think, and I know people talk about this all the time. I feel cliched even saying it. But if they were really going to turn Roman heel, they could have made it work that way. But they didn't really do that.
They didn't. He came out on Raw. They booed him for, like, that opening segment on Raw was almost 15 minutes long.
Yep.
He said 4 words, this is my yard now. Maybe that's 5 words. I don't know. But then, like, and then Heyman came out, gave his promo about, like, the 2 and 23, I don't know my math, that seems right, facing each other, whatever. And then on Raw Talk, Jerry the King Lawler goes in on this whole spiel about, like, you know him, I know him, he's such a good guy, Roman this, Roman that, just, like, slobber-knockered all over him. Like, it's just let him be a fucking heel. The whole audience, everyone hates him. And you can give me the merch numbers and this and that, but like merch numbers are skewed completely as to like how much merch you have, what's available, blah, blah, blah. Like, don't give me that shit. Like, Roman will work if you just let him be a heel.
But see, that's the thing though. Like, you aren't wrong, but the people who say like, Roman makes money, Roman gets a reaction, they aren't wrong either. I don't like Roman obviously has it's not sincere heat, it's like go away heat, but I don't know if at this moment in time, like, WWE or Vince or whoever the fuck is interested in separating those things.
But why can't you do Roman goes heel, is heel for 6 months to a year, and then has, and everyone gets over on him? Because like Roman has all of the things that like would get somebody over, or like the perfect makings of a superstar or whatever, which is why Vince really loves him. But like, why can't Roman get over as a heel, and then everyone loves him as a heel, and then have him turn face and people love him because they already love him?
You can, but WWE is lazy right now and doesn't feel like they need to. At least that's what I see. Because I agree with you. I think Roman should turn heel. I think Roman should have turned heel like forever ago. I'm not a huge Roman Reigns fan, but I also can look at the situation and be like, oh, well, they're fucking lazy. They're not interested in, like, trying new ideas. So for them, they see a reaction and money.
Yeah, that's fair. But
you know what I mean? I don't disagree. I don't disagree with you. I don't think this is fair booking for Roman. I think Roman is a fine wrestler and could get so much farther than he is right now.
Yeah.
But I don't think that they feel they need to.
I had this thought, and this is probably a terrible idea, even if he turned heel, but just a silly thought that I had was, like, if you wanted Roman to turn heel on the Raw after WrestleMania, what if he came out wearing the hat, gloves, and coat?
That would be hilarious. I want Roman. It would be hilarious, but it would also kind of, like, if somebody had to, like, the world needs an Undertaker. So he had to take the place of Undertaker.
That's what Bray should have done.
Well, obviously that's what Bray should have done, but like, LOL, we're way past that fucking point.
I know. I'm sorry.
You don't have to be sorry. I completely agree with you, Megan.
Is Erin okay? Is she still awake? I feel like I haven't heard Aaron's voice in a really long time.
Oh, no. Erin maybe had a little too much feel the glow punch. Erin is currently laying down.
Okay, I was just checking in because I feel like it had been a really long time.
Okay, I'm holding down the fort. She's fine. We've been podcasting for a while.
Yeah.
I didn't make her drink the punch, just to be fair.
I believe you.
Yeah, so like overall I thought Mania was good. It just like it really dipped at the end. But fortunately we had Raw and SmackDown with like lots of like people who are called up and lots of like fun, even if they weren't surprises, they were like well-received rumors. So like, I think in, you know, we made a joke at the beginning, like the ultimate thrill ride, but like it really dipped at the end of Mania and it felt like the air was sucked out of the room. But like, you know, if you have a problem, just bring Shinsuke Nakamura up and everybody will feel better about themselves.
Yeah.
No, I mean, you're right. I thought Mania, like, especially for how bummed out about it I was going into it, I really enjoyed WrestleMania. It dipped at the end, big time, but I thought it was way better than last year's, and I had a good time, generally, watching it.
I agree.
Frankly, there are only two 2.5 matches. I was a little disappointed in the Andre because I really wanted Sammy to win, but I understood what was going on. I was really pissed about Bray and Randy, and I wasn't pissed about Undertaker Roman. It just made me uncomfortable. Like, I literally I got up and I started cleaning, like, up after the party because I was like, I'm uncomfortable watching this match. So, like,
yeah.
I was actually mad about Bray and Randy because, like, Bray absolutely should have won, and I was, like, uncomfortable about the Taker Roman bit. I feel bad for Roman. I like, you know what? I want Roman to get over because I'm like sick of everyone, including myself, hating Roman. I'm just like, he's
too.
There.
And, like,
yeah, I agree.
There were moments.
He's there, so let, match. Let us
Sorry,
make
go ahead.
Him. No, I'm just like, he's there. You clearly like him. You're clearly going to push him. So please just write a storyline where we're allowed to like him. You know?
No, and like, there were moments in this match where a Taker botched some spots because his body couldn't move like he thought it was going to move, and Roman covered really well.
Like,
and so it's not like that. The argument that Roman sucks at wrestling, I don't necessarily think is applicable anymore. Like, it's not 2013. Like Roman's a fine wrestler, and he should better than he is doing right now.
Agreed.
Yeah, I just, like you say, I want to stop having to talk about it all the time. Like this, like the like war of Roman Reigns, because the people, mostly dudes who just can't get over how much they hate Roman and make it like personal, are like completely full of shit. But at the same time, there's a lot of people, and it's usually like women fans who I agree with on almost everything, who try to mount these really strong defenses of him that I don't really agree with either.
Yeah, it's just, hopefully, like, they'll get there.
Yeah, because, like, he is a good wrestler. Like, there's nothing wrong with Roman as a person.
He's obviously very beautiful. Like, we get it. He's handsome. You want us to like him. Just, like, give us a storyline.
Yeah. Like, the booking has just been terrible. And I feel like trying to defend Roman as a character is, at this point, as ridiculous as trying to attack Roman as a person.
Agreed. You know, who knows? Who knows what's going to happen with this superstar shakeup, but hopefully we can move past the Brock and Roman inevitability relatively quickly so that we can move on to more interesting battles like Roman and Finn and what have you. Because I frankly am interested in a Roman Finn feud. I actually really am.
Yeah, I think it could be great.
Maybe because Roman has showed up in one of my weird dreams before. Any other thoughts about WrestleMania 33 before we close out this hell of a podcast?
No, not personally.
No, I feel like we've more than covered it.
Yeah, I agree. Well, it was delightful, in the words of Matt Hardy, broken Matt Hardy, hashtag TM, whatever, don't sue me, TNA. It was great having you guys on. I'm so happy that we got to do this comic book crossover. Why don't you guys tell our listeners where they can find you one more time?
I am at Avarice for Liar on Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat. I just looked at my Twitter, and two people have unfollowed me since I checked earlier today, and that's fucked up. So go follow me. If you can't find me, just search local Aquaman expert. I am the first result, and I am a local Aquaman expert. So if you have questions, I'm here for you.
And yeah, and you know, Aquaman's making his big screen debut this year, so it's going to be a really good year.
Yeah, and I have like really complicated feelings about that. So engage me in discourse.
I'm going to engage you in that discourse because, like, I want to lick Jason Momoa's face, but I also want to know your opinions about him as Aquaman. But maybe on Twitter and not on this podcast
at a later time.
I feel like this is kind of this is a good transition because Jason Momoa and Roman Reigns are kind of doppelgangers.
Right, except for, like, Jason Momoa is, like, clearly way hotter than...
So much hotter.
Well, yeah,
so
but Jason hotter. Momoa is way hotter than any human being that exists.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Okay, did you guys ever see that, like, WWE-sanctioned list that was, like, 10 people that looked like WWE superstars, and Jason Momoa was, like, the person who looked like Roman Reigns?
No, I
wild. Sorry. They just put way more famous people next to wrestlers. And I was like, what? Sorry. Okay. Off topic. Bye.
So you can find me on Twitter at another L. And of course, you can also find, as we said at the beginning of our show, you find our podcast at Hard Times Pod and at hardtimespod.com and on iTunes by searching for the Hard Times Podcast.
Excellent. Well, thank you guys so much for being on our podcast. You can find me at Stella_Cheeks. You can find Erin at ErinGenC. You can find us also at CageSideSeats.com and NotYourDemographic.tumblr.com. You can email us questions, which I promise we'll get to next week. It was just Mania week, so there's lots and lots and lots to talk about. I also started watching Chikara this week, and I've been watching lots of old WrestleManias. I really want to talk about them, so tune in next week for that. That's it. That's all I said. Please rate, review, and subscribe. Also, Elle and Megan, I don't know if you listened to the end, but I need a little help here. So if you could do it with me, closing out our podcast, dummies. Gotta say yeah.
Wait, what?
Yeah. So I'm gonna say dummies, and you say yeah. Ready? Dummies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We did it. We podcast for like 5 hours straight, you guys. I'm very proud of us.
Yes. Go put a blanket over Erin or something.
Yeah, I'm going to send her home. Okay, bye, guys. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you so much. Had a great time.
Yeah, okay. It was awesome. Glorious. No, I won't give in. I won't give in till I'm victorious. And I will defend.
Progressive presents Mind Flowness. With Flow.
You are a mighty fortress of supreme knowledge. Progressive Direct has not only revealed their rates, but those of their competitors. If you were any more in the know, you would be drowning in, you know, the know.
Compare Progressive Direct rates with competitors' rates, because knowledge is power. Visit progressive.com. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and affiliates. Comparison rates not available in all states or situations. Prices vary based on how you buy. Progressive presents Mind Flowness with Flow.
You are a mighty fortress of supreme knowledge. Progressive Direct has not only revealed their rates, but those of their competitors. If you were any more in the know, you would be drowning in, you know, the know.
Compare Progressive Direct rates with competitors' rates, because knowledge is power. Visit progressive.com. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and affiliates. Comparison rates not available in all states or situations. Prices vary based on how you buy.